Overwhelmed by your presence. overwhelmed by your presence. I'm overwhelmed by your presence, Lord Jesus. Overwhelmed by your presence. Overwhelmed by your presence. Overwhelmed by your presence, Lord Jesus. So I'm overwhelmed by your presence. Overwhelmed by your presence. But I'm overwhelmed by your presence. Overwhelmed by your presence. But I'm overwhelmed by your presence. Overwhelmed by your presence, Lord. So I'll rejoice in your love. Oh, and I'll rest in your peace. And delight in your joy. Oh, I'll rejoice in your love, and I'll rest in your peace, and delight in your joy. Oh, oh, I'll rejoice in your love, and I'll rest in your peace, and delight in your joy. us are living here and dwelling here in this perfect love of Jesus. Oh, yes, I'm living here and dwelling here in this perfect love. Yes, I'm living here and dwelling here in this perfect love. Oh, I'm living here and dwelling here in this perfect love of Jesus. Oh, a perfect love. Oh, a perfect love. Oh, a perfect love. Oh, a perfect love. Sing of your love in the morning. Sing of your love at noon. Sing of your love in the evening, Lord. Oh, I'll sing of your love in the morning. Sing of your love at noon. Sing of your love in the evening, Lord, in worship. What perfect love, no greater love than yours, Lord Jesus. Oh, what perfect love, oh, what perfect love, no greater love than yours, Lord Jesus. To the heaven, your faithfulness reaches to the moon. Oh, your faithfulness reaches to the heaven. Oh, your faithfulness reaches to the cloud. Your faithfulness reaches to the heaven. Your faithfulness beyond compare. Your faithfulness is beyond compare. Your faithfulness reaches. reaches to the heaven. Your faithfulness beyond compare. Almighty God, everlasting Father, everlasting One. We open wide the gates for the King of Glory. We open wide the doors for the King of Glory. We open wide the gates. Swing open wide the doors for the King of Glory. We open wide the doors for the King of Glory. We open wide the doors for the King of Glory. We open wide the doors for the King of Glory. We open wide the doors for the King of Glory. We open wide the gates. We swing open wide the doors for the King of Glory. We open wide the doors for the King of Glory. Ride prosperously, oh God, ride prosperously among our midst, among your people here. Ride prosperously among your people, among your church, O Lord. Ride prosperously. Invade every heart, invade every life, invade every heart, invade every life, invade every heart, invade every life. Ride prosperously. We open wide the doors for the King of Glory. We open wide the doors for the King of Glory. We swing open wide the gates. We open wide the doors for the King of Glory. We open wide the gates for the King of Glory. We open wide the doors for the King of Glory. highly exalted among us, Lord. Be glorified, be glorified, highly exalted among us, Lord. Be glorified, be glorified, magnified in our midst, Lord, Lord. Be magnified, be magnified, highly exalted among us, Lord. Be magnified, be magnified, highly exalted among us, Lord. Be glorified, be glorified, highly exalted among us, Lord. Be glorified, be glorified, highly exalted among us, Lord. Be glorified, be glorified, highly exalted among us.
Hallelujah. Lord, we praise you. Great Jehovah, almighty God, our Father, of our Lord Jesus, be revealed. Be magnified, Lord Jesus. You, Lord Jesus, alone reveal the Father, reveal him now. Reveal him now. Reveal him now, O God in me. Holy Spirit, reveal Jesus. Lord Jesus, reveal the Father. Let the whole world see. Let everyone come and behold this glory, this love, this so great a love, this love that you poured out on me. Holy Spirit, reveal Jesus. Lord Jesus, reveal the Father. Father, reveal your Son in me. Let the glory of your power now be seen. Oh, be adored, Lord. Be seen. Be magnified, Lord. Be seen.
You know, we look over time in the New Testament church and we see people who took hold of God, whether they're a man or a woman, whether it was a William Branham, a A.A. Allen, Oral Roberts, a Catherine Coleman, a Benny Hinn, a Rodney Howard Brown, a Carlos Anacondia. It doesn't matter who, whatever name you want to put there. What happened was people began to adore the living God. They began to lay hold on the living God because some man or some woman was willing to stand up against the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life by the strength of the Lord and the power of His might. Because somebody was willing to stand up. And, you know, in many cases we look over the history, we see that many of these folks, they only ran in the display of the power and the glory of God just for a little period of time. And I really don't believe that that's God's will. I believe it's God's will for us to not only step over into that realm where people are being captivated by the presence of God being manifested and revealed through our lives, but that is an ever-increasing glory, an ever-increasing manifestation, to see the formation and the expression of the works of Jesus. Much more than what Father has willed and what He will definitely get His boast out of, to see the greater works. Somebody thinks that that's some kind of an infringement upon the glory and the majesty of the Lord, who alone should receive such honor. But it's pleased Father to choose that same kind of glory be made manifest in us. And all we have to be willing to do is recognize, wait a minute, this isn't God just favoring a couple of different people through the generations of time. This is just a couple of different people in the generations of time willing to step out beyond the status quo, willing no longer to be distracted with the world or secularism, and lay hold on the bounty of heaven. Jesus is the door who's opened wide before us and invited us in. Father standing there inviting us in. The Lord Jesus standing there inviting us in. Holy Ghost grabbing a hold of us and trying to bring us. He won't drag us. Trying to bring us. He'll bring us. He'll put just a little tug on us, which you can easily break away from and turn back from or step aside to. And He'll step aside after us and then grab a hold of us. And with the gentle nudgings, He will try to get us back on track, but He's easy to pull away from. You know, people don't understand this, but it's something that I'm beginning to really learn. And just to recognize the fact that sensitivity to the Holy Spirit demands that we give ourselves completely over to that realm in which He is speaking, in that realm in which He is working. We conflict ourselves and compromise ourselves with all these other things. And it's high time that there becomes a people who are willing to be taught of God, to see things that eyes cannot see and hear things that ears cannot hear and understand things which has never entered in the heart of man, which the Holy Spirit has come to give to us and speak into our lives. But you got to get over your stuff. Most of our stuff is our own little preferences and our own little aggravations and our own little upsets and our own little angers and our own little doubts and our own unbelief. But you know, you can move past that and you can begin to interact with God and experience His manifest glory in such a way that every cloud of darkness and every cloud of doubt is moved out of the way. And you're standing there in the overwhelming presence of the Almighty God, and that's where faith begins to explode in our life. You're standing there knowing that He beholds you, that you're standing in His world, that He sees you, that He hears you, that He has everything absolutely sovereignly under control and defined for our lives. And then you get to step out of that interaction and step before men, and then they get to experience what you were experiencing. I believe that God wants to open up some people's mouths in here to be able to speak on His behalf in 2017. I believe that God wants to begin to grab a hold, that there would be every single one. There's no one God will leave out. But the Lord knows the hearts of men. He knows how many people are really going to even respond to Him. He knows. He's sovereign enough to know and still leave it to your own choice. He's that sovereign. He's that powerful. Because, I mean, I see both in the Scripture. I see where He already knows, and I see where He left it at the will. And then suddenly I came to a realization and understanding that He's so sovereign, He goes beyond what we think sovereign is. He's so sovereign, and he's so glorious and so powerful. He goes beyond what we think glorious and powerful is. And when you think you've understood it, you need to have an encounter with him, because then you'll recognize you didn't understand, and you'll be back at square one. And now he has place to begin to speak to you and give you revelation, give you understanding. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. So many people fell in the ditch of doctrinalizing God while they were supposed to be pursuing intimacy with him. And they stuck down in that ditch, talking about what he did, what he didn't do it. I said it again, talking about what he did, what he really didn't do it. Talking about who he is when that's really not who he is. Declaring things about him that he never did, that he never declared of himself. I really believe that the Lord is going to allow us in his grace and his mercy to his people who are willing. You're not going to go on being the same as you've been. You know, the Lord didn't just have one New Year celebration. He had like 11 each year. Because he had the New Year's celebration of Passover, and then every new moon, it was the same kind of celebration. It was the same kind of shout. Now, Passover did take a preeminence in the way that they were consecrated to come and gather into one place, just like they were with Pesach, Pentecost, and just as they were with the Feast of Tabernacles. But every year was a new moon celebration, because every new moon created a new opportunity, another time to rejoice over all of God's mercies that are new every morning, and the expectation of the thrills of all of his goodness that's about to be bestowed. Don't get too excited. And, you know, I mean, there's one thing that I want to do, and I pray that, you know, we can be more part of starting and just exemplifying the tradition of not participating with the world on New Year's where they're rejoicing over themselves, but where we begin to do as God said in Deuteronomy 16:11 concerning the new year, where we begin to lift up with a shout and with praise, with the sound of the trumpet and with thanksgiving, the trumpet blast of praise and rejoicing, and come to stand before him and begin to shout him. You know, and let me just tell you this. The Lord wasn't pleased with all these people that were coming to shout, because the priest was standing there saying, you got to shout now or we're going to kill you. I mean, that's ultimately what Ezra did. He said, listen, I see one sad place in you, I'm going to knock you upside the head. I'm going to take you out. Go read him. I mean, just go read what he said. And there was a couple of kings that were like that too. We're going to take you out if you're not shouting to our, you know, to our satisfaction as you praise the Lord. The Lord was never satisfied with that. He was never satisfied with it, because people were just doing it ritualistically, even though they were all in it and they were putting everything they had into it. It was just a show of that day and of that moment. Their heart wasn't in it. And he longed for a day where his people, where mankind would receive a new heart and a new spirit, so that they would do it in the heart. And as we ministered to you the other night, God wants to establish truth in your heart so he can give you wisdom, and that's divine insights. And when you got divine insights, I'm telling you right now, you're going to do signs and wonders and miracles. Everybody that the Spirit of the Lord came upon and they received ability to do signs, wonders, and miracles, which is nothing more than just a show that you're standing with God and he's standing with you. That's all that is. It's just the proof. It's the token that he's standing with you and you're standing with him, that you're fully on his side. It's always described as him giving them the spirit of wisdom. He poured out the spirit of wisdom upon them. Hallelujah. Tonight, I'm so excited. Now, I want you to sit down. We're going to sing some more tonight. We're going to do a few things. We're not going to stay here to midnight, because by 9 o'clock, the New Year's already come to America. By 9 o'clock. And I want you to get up in the morning, and I want you to be refreshed. I'm going to talk some more about these things that I believe that the Lord's going to do. And I want to have communion with you tonight. We want to do a number of different things as the Lord will allow us to do it. And you know, first thing I want to do is I want to talk to you about fasting. Some of you go towards fasting with a lot of intimidation. That's your body talking. Okay? That's your body talking. Your body's going to be fine. Your stomach's going to be fine. Your muscle mass will be fine. I tell you right now, you don't have to just fast for 21 days. You keep on going 40 days and you'll look like me. Some of you. I know a guy who weighed about 350 pounds and he just went after it for 40 days. And basically he was as skinny as I am before it was all said and done. And I want to talk to some of you tonight, just give you just some landscape of this, because there are those of you who are working and you can't, you know, it's about fasting and praying, and that's what you want it to be. So when you're fasting, you want to be praying also. So if you're going to work, not a lot of other people can get off work, you should eat breakfast and you should eat lunch and just fast supper And because it's going to be an opportunity. When you get home at 6 o'clock or you get off of work, you're checking the clock, you're saying, I'm now going into fasting and prayer. I'm going into fasting and prayer until I go to sleep, and then go into the night with it. And for some of you, that may really be a big transition. Some of you may not know how to fill an entire day with prayer. But we want you to learn. And what happens is there is a breakthrough. It's like you're contending for something, and suddenly you break over into a realm and you just end this thing, and it's not trying to fill space and time with prayer and trying to think of something to say, but nothing's happening. It's you're overwhelmed by the presence of the Lord. But if you don't contend for that, I'm going to promise you one thing. You're never going to have it. And that's a terrible promise. If you contend for it, you will have it. You will break through into that realm. So I just want to encourage you. Some of you can't, like I said, you eat breakfast, you can eat lunch. Maybe some of you can actually fast it enough to where you could run on breakfast most of the day, and you can just keep yourself kind of running it, you know, lean and mean, and just, you know, at lunchtime you can just get that whole time to prayer. And some of you may have jobs to where that you can, you know, you can be statana basukore mangalia patana moshi predea fatamono paturibina da patana, and it not be, you know, in interfering with what you have to do. So I want you to understand that, but in the context of what God's holds you responsible for. But I want everybody to participate with this over the next 21 days. I mean, for me, it started now, but we're going to have communion. It's already started as the sun went down. And you know, and somebody says, you know, what all are you going to do? Don't worry about what I'm going to do. Just you do what you feel led to do and what God has given you the grace to do. And don't talk among yourself and say, how are you? How many days have you gone? What all have you had? Because that, you know, that really is just spoiling it, okay? Just leave it. Please, just leave it. Because all that's getting into is the wrong motivation. It should be something that's separated between you and the Lord, whether you're doing a juice fast, where you know, having breakfast and lunch, or where you're just having supper at night, or whether you're doing a bread and water fast. That's the Ezekiel fast. You never hear many people talk about the Ezekiel fast, but then once you spend a little time studying and thinking about the logistics of Ezekiel laying on one side, having bread and water, not allowed to get up for a year, then laying on the other side, pretty radical stuff. The Lord is able to do a lot of miraculous, supernatural things. It's 100% use of whatever you got. Huh? Right. Not needing to have to go to the restroom or anything. Pretty miraculous stuff. The Lord could do some miraculous things. I mean, Moses went up into an interaction with the Lord. Listen, dear people, when you're in his presence, you don't need to eat. I mean, when you're in presence like that, where his fingers like writing on tables of stone, you don't need to eat. Okay? Where you're so overwhelmed with his glory, your face like the sun. You don't need to eat. You're getting all the energy and all the nutrients that you need just standing there looking at him. And not even looking at him, just being near where he's at that level. And I know of men and women who talk about it in the great moves of the Spirit. I had Ron Moore just recently contact me. He's the grandson of the prophet Moore. The prophet Moore prophesied over me before I was born. He was one of the guys that were right there along with a whole league of great men of God at the beginning of what was called the Latter Rain Revival that started in the 40s and the 50s. And Ron Moore is writing a book about it right now, trying to put all the pieces together. My dad was involved in it as a young man. He was right in the big middle of it, so he was contacting me to get a hold of my dad. But at any rate, people, they talked about how that they could just go. They could go without sleep. They would be under such a radiant move of the presence and the power of God, signs and wonders and miracles and the exploits of God happening on such a level, such incredible miracles. They didn't need to sleep, and they didn't need to eat. And for whole periods of time, then of course their body would, you know, need to go to rest. They go rest for a couple of days. But, you know, there is a place of walking with God and walking in God where there is a supernatural work of divine grace. I want you to listen real careful. Supernatural work of divine grace that gives us the ability to begin to press in into a realm of not being preoccupied or distracted with other things. And you could begin to taste that and touch that in the prayer life. And I've heard this all of my life, and it is true. You know, if you want to have a strong faith life, you have to have a strong prayer life. And if you want to have a strong prayer life, you have to give yourself to a strong fasting life. So fasting is a help to prayer. Prayer is a help to faith. And so, you know, I pray that you'll use this time, and it's the beginning of the year. We're going to have some shouts and rejoicing before the Lord tonight. I believe that the Lord's going to to do some wonderful things for everybody's hearts who are in expectation. But I just wanted to make sure that you recognize that you could do any part of this. Maybe some of you, all you can do is the weekend, Saturdays and Sundays. But I'm going to tell you right now, Doug, walk in here like he's basically dead on Sundays. See, I'm telling me you fasted. Give me a break. You need to get some grace, you know. And so if you're gonna be walking in here like a dead man, eat some breakfast before you come in, or a dead woman. You know what I'm saying? Get yourself some energy. Come on, you know, please. Dear people, you know, if there is a grace to do it, there is a grace to do it, and that grace is born out of relationship and earnestness and a cry and a plea. You know, when we approach fasting and prayer, you can't be doing it because I said to do it. You can do some part of it because I said to do it. I mean, like I said the other day, some of you might actually be able to fast an hour or fast a meal. And, you know, I was saying that, of course, just joking. But, you know, I want you to find some part of it that you afflict your soul. Okay? So you say, why did I afflict my soul? What's that for that? Well, you know, I don't know all the dimensions of it. I don't even begin to understand it. But I know that when Daniel did it, he had some great results. I know that when Nineveh did it, they got some great results. I know when Ahab did it, he got some great results. Anybody who did it, no matter how close or how far away from God they were, when they did it, they got some great results. And I was fasting one time, and I think I was 18 or 19 years old, and my uncle, who's a Northern Baptist guy, came into the room and he says, "You're fasting. What are you, demon possessed or something?" And he said, "These shall go out only by fasting and prayer." Hello, hold up a second. Time out. Jesus fasted for 40 days. Come on, give me a break. There is a moving of God. There's the moving and the compulsions of the Holy Spirit that draws us into a place of separating ourselves unto the Lord because we're asking, we're contending for something. We're letting the Lord know on a level that it just goes beyond any other possible way that we can do it while we're here in this frame. I think, I obedience is a wonderful thing. Obedience to the point where you're saying, "I'm not even going to eat. I'm not even going to eat, Lord. I'm esteeming, you know, you and what your work and what you purpose to do through my life and what I'm desperate for you to do in my life. More important to me than the necessary food." Listen, the Lord's opened up so many doors for us here in 2017. I mean, we're going to be going to some of the great churches of America. God's allowed us to go, and I don't want to go with anything less than great exploits of God. I want the tokens that the Lord is with me and that I'm with Him, that I'm a part of His army, a part of His, you know, plan to rescue humanity from sin and darkness. I want the tokens and the signs and the wonders that, you know, I'm executing the will of the Father in the earth and doing the work of the ministry of Jesus. I mean, praise God, the Lord has filled me with this word, but I'm gonna bring His word with a demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power with signs and wonders. I know that Father's looking for people who will speak on His behalf in the year 2017. You know, I think actually, I'm going to tell you this, it's going to kind of unsettle some of you maybe, that are, especially of you that are watching, some of you that are watching me by the web, but actually I think that the church is in a more scary, threatening situation right now with the Trump administration than they would have been with the Clinton administration. With the Clinton administration, the church would have been potentially more passionate and more aggressive and would have had to have been by force because of the mandates, ungodly antichrist mandates that would have been being executed. But now all of a sudden people can begin to, you know, kick back and think, well, you know, somehow this administration is going to change things. I want you to know something. God, if God could have changed anybody legislatively and judicially, I mean, Israel would have been a bunch of saints under Moses' leadership. Are you listening to me? They had been a better governor, a better leader than Moses. They'd have been a bunch of saints. If a governmental power, a legislative power could do anything, legislative governmental powers cannot change the heart of men. And we in greater crisis than we've ever been in before. But this is a great opportunity for the church to shine bright. Amen. I'm certain that, once again, that if we as co-laborers together with the Lord Jesus Christ of His building, He's got a building, His building, His temple is His church. Hallelujah. He's the temple builder of Zechariah chapter 6. His church is His temple. Hallelujah. He's Mambrondea, Steamondekaya. Peter talks about it. Peter talks about it. First Peter. Paul talks about it in Ephesians. He's the temple builder. His church is his temple. It's a place of his glory and of his manifest power and of his manifest presence being seen on a level where God is manifested with all the fullness of his person. But we have to cooperate with that. And if we don't cooperate with that, dear people, we're not going to see what Father's intended. What Father has willed has got to be bigger than what we've willed. And we'll say, Father, not my will, but your will. But hold up. When we see that what's going on in our everyday life is not God's will, what are we going to do to arrest that? When we see what's going on in our church service is not what he's willed. And listen, it's not thy will, O God, in an esoteric, I don't know what that is way, because he's clearly defined what his church is supposed to look like, what his church is supposed to be doing, how we're supposed to be acting, how we're supposed to be interacting with one another. And if we're not willing to pursue that and press in to have that, if we're not willing to do whatever it takes in laboring together with him, with his building, and with his husbandry, then there is absolutely no way we're going to ever run any kind of an opportunity or a chance of seeing those things happen in our lifetime. Maybe somebody else gets it. While we're sitting around talking about it, somebody else goes and does it. I'm going to tell you right now, that would be the worst insult. That would be the worst thing I could possibly ever encounter, is that here I am, you know, speaking about it, passionate about it. I understand it. I know it, but I didn't pursue it enough to have it. And somebody over knew a fraction of what I knew, had greater passion to pursue it and laid hold on it and went with it. Give me a break. I'm not going to even run the risk. But I know that if we're building, if we're laboring together with him in the design and the structure of his building, as he's described it, where all the fullness of his power and glory, where all the fullness of Jesus is being made manifest. The church is his body. It's the living personality of Jesus Christ in the earth. And that expression is only understood within the framework of the gifts of the Spirit being manifested on the level of exploits that Jesus himself did. And even greater. I mean, it's just where you and I, we don't have all this crazy stuff going on. You know, let me just say this. People who have lived their life in the church, they run the greatest risk of being the biggest hypocrites. Especially if they cheated and their parents let them get away with stuff. And then all of a sudden, all they're doing is just messing the whole program out. I'm going to messing the whole program up. You know, God gives you an opportunity and a space of time to repent. But give me a break, man. You know, get over yourself. Either go for the devil or go for God. Quit, you know, messing with the program. You know, the reality of it is the Lord tells us to purge out the old leaven. Don't allow that stuff, especially don't allow it to be mixed in the offering. The offering of worship is the most important thing to me. Most of you know, people have been around me for a long time, man. I expect you cross-examine you, look you up and down, and then wait to have dreams about you before you're ever going to get on the platform with me. And the reality of it is what Father did was he always protected me, because if anybody ever got on a platform with me, it wasn't long until just everything, and they weren't walking right, it wasn't long until everything just fell apart in their life. Everything. Because it's the fire of God. It's the fire of God. You get on the platform with somebody, you're messing around with God and you're not living right, everything begins to fall apart. I mean, the body falls apart, the spirit falls apart. Why? Because fire of God. I mean, the reality of it is, his Father's gracious and he's merciful. But there needs to be the fear of the Lord in our midst. Amen. I mean, you know, it's just like when you look at full-blown revival in the book of Acts, their church growth plan was everybody was afraid to join their church. Isn't that true? That's what the scripture says. Everybody was afraid. And the King James says, and they durst fear to join themselves unto them. Now, let me give you the modern day translation of durst fear to join yourself unto them. They were afraid to come to their church. Why? Because you lie and you're going to fall down dead. You're going to mess with it, because the Lord says, I've got a house. I want my house to be pure. I want my house to be holy. I don't want nobody, you know, offering up some crazy stuff, doing some crazy stuff, running interference with all of their stuff, the hypocrisy especially. Listen, people, God's grace, don't get me wrong, God's grace and love and mercy and forgiveness is excessive. It's excessive. It is just there. It's an abundance of mercy. It's an abundance of grace. His mercies are new every morning for people who want to get it right. For people who are just, they don't want to really get it right. They come in, they stay posing, they singing, they doing it for mom or doing it for dad or doing it for the husband, doing it for the wife, or doing it for some kind of a show of thing. And in their heart, they have pleasure and unrighteousness in their heart. That all they want to do is get back and that other life. You know what? You're going to end up, let me tell you what happens to people around the fire of God. They end up One of three things: schizophrenic, multiple personalities, or bipolar. Because they live it spiritually. They give themselves over to it spiritually. They give a double life, multiple personalities. And when all of a sudden, when you do that and the fire of God's burning and you're messing around, I'm going to tell you right now, judgment falls. It falls. It falls. And I'm just giving you a warning because, you know, I've heard over and again, people who are sitting around the table talking about what is it going to take to see the power of God and the moving of the Spirit of God take place in this church like the Bible describes. So God's Father's building is what He described and what He's willed, and we're laboring together with Him to see that building erected. And, you know, I've heard over and again people say, well, we're just not ready because too many people would fall down dead if we had that kind of manifest presence of God's glory, because there's a bunch of cheaters, liars, and hypocrites in the church. Posers, people not real sincere with God. They've been allowed to basically cheat, get away with saying, cheat on God, cheat on God. It's just it's a crazy concept, but it's true. And, you know, Paul says it. He's given us this formula, as it were. He's given us the recipe, rather, better said, for a move of God, a sustained move of God in 1st and 2nd Corinthians. He gives us a recipe. And one part of the recipe is make sure you don't have any leaven. This is part of the recipe. Get rid of the leaven. He tells us right to the first chapter how to sustain. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 tells us how to sustain for a long period of time the outpourings of the Spirit of the Lord to where that the move of God is on the level where when people come in our midst, they say, God truly is in this place. I mean, the manifest presence of the Lord. Can you just imagine that there is a place that you could go? I'm looking at more than a possibility of where I'm going to go over the next 21 days. I'm looking at more than just a possibility of where I'm going to go over the next 21 days. I'm looking at an opportunity that is set before me to where that I can begin to step into interaction with Father on another level and experience that glory and that life. And level's wrong word, forgive me, another dimension. And begin to experience that dimension, those dimensions of His height, His breadth, His length, and His depth, to where that in that conversation with Him and in that interaction with Him, I'm able then to supply, as it were, because of that communication, because of that interaction, because of that relationship, that same encounter to other people. Because as I minister, what I'm ministering out of the relationship that I have with Him is what I'm ministering from. And so that then produces an encounter. In whatever relationship you have with the Lord, you're going to minister out of that relationship, and that's all you're going to get. That's all that you're going to have, what you received from heaven. And the reality that you and I could stand here in this place and begin to speak the Word of God in such a way that the presence of the living God invades the hearts and lives of people on a level that's beyond anything that could be categorized as normal. It is an experience beyond anything they've encountered. Listen, I'm going to tell you right now, I know what's happened year after year, time after time. As soon as one man, one woman stands up against a function like that, suddenly there's tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions of people come rushing into the kingdom. Because the reality of it is, try to wake up. The reality of it is, try to keep some attention here. The reality of it is, listen to me, the reality of it is that people are hungry for God, they're just not seeing Him. Hello? People are hungry for the move of God, they're just not seeing it. Come on now. The Baptists, the Episcopalians, the Roman Catholics, listen, the Methodists, listen, make sure that God is most important to you. Not your furniture, not your car, not your clothes, not your job, not your stuff. You make sure that you recognize that you are up against a powerful foe that uses the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life to bring you into a place where that somehow, to some degree, you are compromising with those things enough to disrupt this flow of heaven through your life. And Father has afforded to you and me the strength of the Lord and the power of His might. As soon as you and I just recognize, wait a minute, the pleasures of this world is nothing but death and destruction, and we allow God in His mercy and grace to strengthen us to shut that stuff off, we begin to enjoy the pleasures that are in His presence. And you get so excited about the pleasures that are in His presence that what was pleasures in this world looks to you as some defiled thing that is horrific to you. True. It's true. The wisdom of the Lord, the insights of the Lord, the understanding of the Lord, the knowledge of the Lord causes us to hate evil. We look on it and go, that is disgusting. That is absolutely the worst, most horrific thing. Unbelievable. In my life I was attracted to that. You mean the world is attracted to that demonic, devilish thing? Yeah, the knowledge of the Lord, the wisdom of the Lord, the understanding of the Lord, that's what happens. He gives us that. But we have to recognize that there has to be a separation. And this is what I want you to do over the next 21 days. And this is really one of the things I'm driving at here by the Spirit of the Lord. I don't care what you do, whether you're fasting breakfast, lunch, or supper, or all three of them, whether you're doing a bread and water fast, whether you're doing a water fast, whether you're doing a juice fast, whether you're doing, you know what they call it, Daniel fast, where you're just having light vegetables, just a little bit of light vegetables every day. Whatever it is that you're doing for 21 days, no TV, no radio, nothing secular. You look down, just a few of you stand there and shake your head at me. I know you're addicted. Yeah. You watch. Yeah. You talk about fasting food. Some of you break out into a cold sweat in 4 days. Some of you maybe after 4 hours. You gotta have your TV fix or whatever, your news fix or whatever. It's addictive. Huh? I want you to cut yourself off from that which is secular for 21 days. That which is secular. Because, well, I can't even say worldly anymore. Nobody knows what that is. It's a lost definition. Worldly, what's that? That's something terribly gross, demonic. That's where you're like killing people or something. No, worldly, secular. Anything that belongs to this world, it's worldly. Anything that is secular, what everybody else is enjoying, worldly. Huh? It wasn't created, inspired by God the Holy Ghost. Think about it. Cut it off. You sit there staring at your Facebook. Cut it off. Amen. Cut it off. There's only one or two people who have permission to use Facebook. I'm one of them. Because I'll be posting ministry stuff the whole time. Okay? And I won't be going through and scrolling and liking your stuff that you're not doing. Are you with me? Yeah. I'm not going to be able to scroll through, you know, and like whatever you're posting because you're not posting. Right? You're not even there. You know, some of you, if you don't absolutely have to, shut your phones off. If you don't absolutely have to have them on, shut your phones off. Huh? I'm so proud of William Spitzberg, and you can't get a hold of him. Why? Because he was having a bit of an issue with his phone. He gave his phone away and hasn't taken it back. You got to go run him down, or you got to find somebody who's close to him that has a phone and get in contact with him. Praise God for William. Praise God for people who are going to give themselves over to being valiant men. Huh? Come on, people. The Lord wants to give to us of people who know how to truly walk with God, who aren't posers and pretenders and high-fiving God and sneaking around with the devil. Come on, give me a break. You know, listen, people, you hate it when you find out somebody's been talking bad about you behind your back. I'm going to tell you right now, it's infinitely worse for you and I to be standing there praising the Lord, worshiping God, and acting like we're intimate with him to just leave and go out and hang out with the devil. Give me a break. I mean, come on. Huh? Listen to me. It's just, I can't even find a way to describe that, okay? But one of the ways I could potentially describe it is that your wife comes to you, she tells you that she loves you, she vows herself to you, and you're constantly finding her walking around with several different men. How is that going to make you feel? A little bit outraged? A little bit outraged? Huh? A little bit provoked? Come on, think about it. People, when you read in the Bible how God is angry, how his wrath is stirred up, if you read anything in the Bible at any length, at any time, you find out that God's wrath and his anger is completely stirred up, mostly on a continual basis. Because the reality of it is, it's only his mercy and his grace that it's not been completely annihilated and wiped out long ago. He in his mercy, he stood back waiting for one or two or three or four or five, or he would take 5,000 or 5 million or 500 million, whatever. It's just the reality of it is most of people don't want to serve God. They don't like God. You know, one of the things I said the other night, make a list of what God needs to do different so you'll like him better. Some people would like God a whole lot more if they didn't have to give money in the offering. They'd like God a whole lot more. They could get rid of the offering for church. Some people would like God a whole lot more if they could, you know, do this sin or that sin or this iniquity or that iniquity. Huh? They would like God a whole lot more. Because you have to think about it. The things that you are allowing in your life are the things that God doesn't like and that you don't like about him. And so you're cheating on him because you don't like what he said. You don't like that he said, don't do this. And then, and you want to do it. You don't like him. You don't like him for that. Think about it a little bit more. I'm not going to go into that tonight. I'm going to revisit Wednesday night. Wednesday night's recorded. It's, praise God, it's history. But yet it's in the future too because it's available. It's history. It's present tense. You can go and play it right now. And it's available in the future. Isn't that amazing? Hallelujah. I love it. I love to go to bed and sleep at night recognizing that I'm preaching. I wake up in the morning, I'm getting these things from, you know, other countries in Europe, in Africa. Wow, I just got so blessed by the message that I just listened to, and it was while I was sleeping. So 2-3 o'clock in the morning, I'm just like snoring up a storm. And my wife and her mercy towards me. And she hasn't told me to get a Zippo yet. You know, sometimes I fall asleep and I'm just gone. Daniel said he thought there was some terrible thing happening outside. He said he thought the dogs were fighting outside. And then he realized it was Dad downstairs sleeping. It was a terrible thing. But meanwhile, I'm preaching. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen, people. We're going through a breakthrough. I believe that everything that God said in His Word is available to you right now and to me right now, and I'm not going to live without it. And I'm going to tell you right now, I've been going after this for many years. I'm more passionate than ever before. I'm thanking Father in His mercy for the growth, the maturity, the ability to be able to see, to just lay hold on those things. I'm becoming more intolerant with sin and Christian sinners than ever before. I'm becoming totally intolerant with it. I'm getting intolerant. Totally. It just doesn't even belong. It just isn't even right. And you may find yourself being overcome with things. But listen, I'm going to tell you right now, sins or things that, you know, are disobedience or wrong. I'm going to tell you right now, just give yourself to get wanting to be right. I mean, because Father has given to us His life and His life more abundantly. Just give yourself to wanting to be right. And I'm telling you, you've got all the help that you could possibly ever want. Father has given us not only Christ Jesus to intercede for us, He's given us the Holy Ghost to strengthen us and help us. I mean, the angels that go forth and are ministering spirits for us who are heirs of salvation. I mean, we got it made. And the more you lay hold on this, the more you want it, dear people. The more you occupy yourself with the things in this world, the less you want God. And there's that mixture. The more you give place to the suggestion of the devil, the more you doubt whether or not God exists or whether the things He said He would do, He's going to do. The more you give place to secularism, whether it's Christian secularism or worldly secularism, it's both secularisms are worldliness. So it's Christian worldliness, okay? Or it's worldliness. And actually, they're the same. It's just one is worse than the other. And guess which one's worse? It's the Benedict Arnold. It's the traitors in our ranks. It's the Judases in our ranks. It's the people constantly committing treason against Him and profaning His holy name with their unholy actions. Huh? Come on, people. Listen, this year, take a hammer to whatever's in your way. Get real with God. If your eyes offend you, become an eye plucker. Pluck that bad boy out. Let's listen. And if you don't get it all the way out, we want to see you red-eyed from trying. Come on, man. We want to see you red-eyed from trying. Come on. Listen, if you got a hand that's big and giving you some problems, get that thing cut off. And let's listen. Come on, man. At least we want to see some stitches for you going after it in Jesus' name. Listen, if your foot has been taking you in the wrong places, I mean, get the chainsaw out. Come on, take that thing off. Take it off. Clean it up all the way through. Come on. Let's see some scars from trying, if nothing less than that. Because I'm going to tell you right now, when you get to going to plucking that bad boy out, you're going to be finding out that fasting is an easier route. Fasting and praying and seeking God. You're going to be looking for some other plan A's before you basically, resort to such drastic measures. But this is the sermons of Jesus. We make light of them. We act like they don't really even apply. Theologians explain them away. But He was serious. He was serious. He said it's better for you to enter into life as one-eyed Jack than being thrown into hell with your beautiful self. Your hell. It's thrown into hell, an eternity in hell. It's just that real. The consequences are that real. People want to say it's not that real. They are that real. Yeah.
They are that real. 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 I want you to think about it. I want you to think about the reality that God may indeed know who's going to heaven and who's going to hell, but and yet be so sovereign enough that he will not interfere with your will and the decisions and opportunities that you have to make, but he just knows. Huh? And that's a good thing to talk to him about. Pops! Pops! Tell me where I stand with you! Are you with me? Because if you got this, you'd be like, well, Papa knows whether I'm going to make heaven or hell. I want to know now too! How will I hold? I'm going to get a firm grip on eternal life. Oh, God! Now you got yourself something to pray about. Now you're not trying to figure out how to fill space and time with whatever little prayer you're going to pray. Amen. You know, this laying now, I lay me down and pray, sleep, prayer. Now I lay me down and sleep prayer. It's just absolutely just nothing but terrible. It's just terrible. It's just a declaration of somebody who hasn't really slipped into truth yet. Hasn't slipped into reality. Because the reality of it is that we have an eternity we're faced with. We have this glorious opportunity, this heavenly realm to live in right now. I mean, the word, the faith healing movement of 1880 that people like A.B. Simpson came out of, and so many great people that we could talk about that emerged from that flow of God's presence and glory. The things that happened in the Pentecostal revival of 1906 and that lasted at least until 1916, 1920, the great movings of God then that took place again in the early 1940s and then exploded by the 1950s. Father's earnest to bring these things to pass. He's just looking for some people that are earnest with him. There was an entirely different perspective on how to approach God and how to go after God than there is now. People weren't all just high on the fluff and stuff. People were not like they are at this moment in time, where there's all of this love, and it's almost an ardent love in people's lives for earthly things, for materialism. That just didn't exist in the church. Didn't exist in the church in the 40s and the 50s. Sorry, there would be no prosperity teaching in the 40s and the 50s. And they had a greater move of God than we have today. Sorry, there was no prosperity teaching in the early 20th century, in the 1906. There was none, and they had a greater move of God. I'm not saying that we can't, see the blessings of God come into our life, but I'm going to see that I see people running after all these things that run contrary to what God's called us to do. It's seeking after materialism rather than the things of the Spirit. Amen. Come on, people. There's some things here that we need to look at a little bit closer. And the only one that can really help us look at them a little closer is the Spirit of Truth, grabbing hold of the Word of God. I care not who they are. I trust not the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. I grab a hold of the Word of God, and I cling to it. I'm saying, Holy Spirit, you take this thing and let this fire begin to burn in me, to where I'm cleaving into the Word of God. To the Word alone, laying hold on His life, laying hold on eternal life. So, back to this, grabbing a hold of what the will of the Father is for the church right now. What is the church supposed to look like? Does Father want the church to be big? Does it say anything about it? He wants the church to be strong. He wants the church to be full of the Holy Ghost. He wants the church with signs and wonders and miracles. He said nothing about numbers. He never said nothing about numbers. He says, as many as the Lord added unto them. That's how many people were in the church. As many as the Lord added. Added. Have you ever looked at the evangelistic programs of the church as you look at it within the framework of just what is revealed by the Lord Jesus Christ and by the apostles in the book of Acts? It's the church so full of the fire and the glory of God, of sitting in His manifest presence, that they go out just on the way home and the power of God erupts. Signs and wonders and miracles, the deaf hear, the blind see, the crippled walk. That's what it was. And primarily that focus was on the apostles more than anyone else because of just, obviously the amount of space to write. But yet, when you look in the church at Corinth, you see everybody functioning in some dimension of these gifts with a cry and with a call that all of it's available for you, that all the fullness of God is available for you. So they're functioning in all these signs and wonders and miracles, and you got Paul saying, look, come on, step into all the fullness of God. Here he's talking to a group of people that are functioning, and they're having every dimension of the manifestation of the presence of God, word of knowledge, word of wisdom, discerning of spirits, working of miracles, gifts of healing, gifts of faith. It's going on, prophecy, tongues, interpretation of tongues. And he's saying, go ahead, come on now. Bow your knee before the Father in heaven, whom every family in heaven is named, that you be strengthened by the Spirit in your inner being, so that you, being rooted and grounded and settled in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, and there be filled with all the fullness of God. He's calling us in. He's calling everybody in. Yes, you've tasted. Yes, there's the presence and the power and the glory of God being made manifested in your life. Yes, you're blessed with all spiritual blessing in heavenly places. Now we want you to step over into a realm where you begin to understand the exceeding greatness of His power that's yours. The exceeding greatness of His power that is yours. It's yours because Jesus has raised it from the dead and seated as an authority above all other authorities. This is Paul crying out and to the church at Ephesus, which is a cry to all of the churches functioning in many of the same dimensions. I'm certain that are functioning in many of the same dimensions, if not greater dimensions, than what is highlighted in what Paul addresses to the church at Corinth. It's just that he highlights church at Corinth because of the specific nature of what he's addressing, a longevity of the move of God, and getting things right to where that it's pure. It's a pure flow. It's a pure flow. Hallelujah. It's a bold esteem to Matadea. It's a pure flow. Somebody said, well, they had this thing and that thing and the other thing going on while they had those manifestations of the gifts of the Spirit. Yeah, but they were dealing with it and they were getting it out and they were rebuking it. Don't try to tell me that somehow that is a justification for the state that the church finds itself in now, because if it was really sorted out, there's worse things going on in the church today than what was going on then. And what Paul is addressing is, says, we want this flow to continue. We want this pure flow to get stronger. And if it's going to get stronger, then the people that are allowed to come into the place that are just hanging out and taking advantage of the presence of the living God, that have this thing going on in their life or that thing going on in their life, you get them out. You deal with it. Otherwise, it's going to shut the thing down. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
So it's so important, people, that we just recognize, look, God's got the best thing going on. If you don't want to serve Him, you don't have to, but He's got the best thing going on. And listen, people say, well, it's either God's way or hell. You know what? Praise God. Yes, that's true. It's either God's way or hell, because the reality of it is only God's way is the way of love and joy and peace. Everybody, listen to me. Think about this, people. Everybody wants to be happy. But only what Father's shown us. Only what He's taught us, only His life and His ways bring happy. Everybody, that's all the gospel is. Come and receive life. Come and receive happy. Everybody wants to have longevity of relationships and not continue to destroy relationships. But the only way that's possible is obeying what God says to do, walking in His way. That's the only way love is going to continually be revealed through our lives. Just simply obeying God's word ultimately results in everything being good. It's just that true. It's just that simple. It's just really that simple. And when you want to walk other than the way that God has revealed this is the way of life, all you've got is death and disaster. It's proven over and over and over again. So tonight, once again, I'm calling you. I'm saying to you, what do you want with your life? Let everyone who's going to serve God come and consecrate themselves.
Amen.
You know, it's a sad thing when you look at Joshua. And here he is, he's led Israel, and a great generation, a generation that says, whether we live or whether we die, we're going to do what God says to do. You got us. We're all in. Doesn't matter. Whatever you say to do. If we're going to fast 21 days, we're all in it. If we're going to go through the Jordan, we're all in it. If we're all going to go out there and fight guys that are 10 times bigger than we are, we're all in it. Doesn't matter. We're all in. Whether we live or whether we die, we're going to do whatever you say. Huh? He's got a great generation. But by the time he's old and they've gone through signs and wonders, you talk about revival. You know, this is like, that's Bible. I mean, I didn't even know that was available. Revival is when you're going after the things that you've left behind that are available, but you're not using. That's revival. That's why the church needs to have a revival. I had a preacher say to me, he said, don't say revival. I said, well, what would you like me to say? He said, advancement. I said, what are you talking about? We need to be revived, in other words, to function in the gifts of the Spirit, the work and the power of God that was already revealed in the midst of the church, because it's not happening. Is it happening in your church? Well, it's not advance. Well, we're going for the greater works. What do you mean you're going for the greater works without the works? Shouldn't we have the works before we have the greater works? Doesn't that make sense? Huh? Well, somebody says, well, I want to have the life of Jesus, but I don't want to have the consecration of Jesus. You can't have it. You can't have it. You're saying that you're better than Jesus if you can have the power of God manifested in your life without the same kind of yieldedness and obedience that he had to the Father. And come on, you're not better than Jesus. You're not better than Jesus. Are you listening to me? Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
Hello. And my goodness, you know, you try to answer the question, why did he need to fast and pray? And I guarantee you, for 40 days and 40 nights, and I guarantee you it wasn't the only time he fasted and prayed. He was constantly giving himself to prayer. And he shows to you and me, and you need to get this, because some of you are going to get to step in. Some of the people in this place are going to get to step in to the exploits of the power of God through their life. Some of the people in this place, you're going to get to step in to the exploits of God in your life. And you got to understand the principles of Jesus. At the end of the meeting, they didn't go out and sup. And when we say sup, banquet, they didn't go to Denny's for pancakes and bacon or to any other place, some people for steak dinners or for a huge, you know, banqueting feast. Jesus, on the greatest miracle nights, he didn't go congratulate themselves. We all congratulate, wow, what a great move of God. Man, we're famous more than we ever were before. Whoa, the offering was huge. They went and prayed. He went and prayed all night. He got alone and went and prayed. And the thing about it is the more that you begin to deal with the issues of failure and success, the more you're going to find yourself living in a consecrated place of talking to the Father. Because he's going to settle all that mess, because it's a bunch of nonsense and lies. Huh? Because the Holy Ghost in the checklist coming out after the meeting going, success, failure, failure, success, success. And reality of it is what he does in his lies, Satan, that is, he comes in the greatest success and does nothing but minister failure if he cannot minister his deceit, a conceit. Where people are all high on themselves, look at what I've done, look at what I've achieved, look at what I've accomplished. Nonsense. Shut all that stuff down. Be hid away in God. Just where this presence is so sacred, so wonderful. Lord, I'm so amazed, Lord, that you would even move like this, that I even got to be in this meeting. Amen. This is so wonderful. Yes. This is so glorious. And you keep yourself where it's a place you're continually overwhelmed in awe. Amen. Of his working, his mighty working power. But, you know, you're not going to be in awe of his mighty working power in the midst of all of these things going on if you weren't in awe of his mighty working power that caused you to lay hold on it. All these things in God are free, but they're still sacred. And so therefore, he says, it's free. I open up the door for you. Come on in. But I'm going to tell you right now, you have to hunger and thirst for it. It's got to be one. In other words, he's saying it's got to be more important to you than anything else that you have and anything else you want. Otherwise, you're going to pollute it and contaminate and destroy yourself. Period. And there's many examples of it. Many examples of it. People just want to have a little bit of this and a little bit of that. I don't want a little bit of God. I'm not interested in a little bit of the move of the Spirit. I'm not interested in good meetings. I'm interested in the moves of God. The moves of God. The moves of God. Let me tell you what the moves of God are. The moves of God are when all of a sudden you turn around and there's 10,000 people there. Because that's what happens in the moves of God. That's what happens in the moves of God. Good meetings, where you go to the meeting, wow, the presence of God was there, the singing was good, a few people got healed, a couple of people got saved, really saved. Listen, I told some preachers one time, they were counting all the people that they had supposedly were getting saved. I said, no. I said, I want you to do me a favor. Why don't you count the people that get water baptized and come back and are planted in the church? Count them. Nobody wants to participate with that program. Because all of a sudden you start counting them and wait a minute. Huh? I'm not feeding them, going, picking them up, diapering them and giving them an extra, honorarium for coming to the meeting or whatever. It's just crazy. I mean, the landscape of that is just diverse across the United States and Europe. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Jesus, give him an allowance. You know? Well, one guy said, listen, it's good to pay people $10 a head to come. $10. You know, it's worth their time. 1 hour, they get $10. We'll give them a free ride and some lunch. Okay, well, fine. But who got saved? In other words, who didn't need the $10 and the ride and the lunch to come back? Are you with me?
Yes.
Well, what is the Lord? Come on, what? I'm talking about move of God. I'm talking, come on, come. Please. I'm hoping I got somebody listening to me.
Yes.
Besides just, somebody's listening to me and your heart's going boom, boom. Huh? And it's not just like, oh, what is he saying now and how late are we going to be here tonight? And I thought we were going to worship more. Well, we want to worship more. You get to worship more when you get this.
Amen.
Worshiping more isn't getting to sing another song. That could be worshiping less. True. Worshiping more is where you're hungry for him and you lay hold on him. You got to have him. Jesus. Jesus. Paul toromo si prata gilena. I'm going to say this to you. None of you are under obligation. Nobody's under any obligation. Father doesn't want any obligated kisses any more than you do. He doesn't want any obligated appearances, obligated hugs, huh? Obligated reverence. He wants none of it. He's after the true worshiper who worships in spirit, in truth, who really his heart is in it. There's no obligation here. I'm asking you to participate for 21 days with us, but there's no obligation here. I want to stir hunger in you. I want to stir hunger. If I can't stir hunger, there's no fire. There's not even fire there. If I can't stir hunger, if I'm poking you with the Holy Ghost poker, and the flame's not, and there's no flame moving, at best you smoke. And the good news is that the Lord wouldn't put out a smoking wick. Smoking wick more than likely will not ignite. But he's still not going to quench your smoking wick. Praise God for the smoking wicks. But if I'm poking you with the Holy Ghost poker right now, trying to stir within you hunger, and we're not getting a flame, I'm going to get a little aggravated. I'm going to say, Lord, what do we have to work with here? Huh? Come on. And I know that for the most part, people in here, you know what would keep you from the Holy Ghost being able to produce hunger in you? Offense, unforgiveness, unwillingness to cooperate with God, harboring sin. It doesn't matter how much we poke you, there won't be a flame. I'll poke you again, won't be a flame. But the flame of God is easy to see. The movings of God are easy to see. The anointing of the Holy Ghost in people's lives is easy to see. It's easy to see when all of a sudden there is not a communication of the things of the Spirit. It's a communication of the Spirit to humanity. It's true. It's true. You don't want that in your life. And so, you know, if I can just provoke you in any way, encourage you in any way, stir hunger within you in any ways, say, listen, I need to lay hold on God. How do I lay hold on God? You begin to seek him. How do you seek God? Prayer and fasting. You draw nigh unto him. You call upon him while he's near. Seek the Lord while he may be found.
Amen.
Praise God that he's here.
Yes. Amen.
Praise God that he's it right now. We get to, it's the issue of we're making a decision to whether or not we want to participate with God in the things that he wants to do. Not the things that you think are good to do. Not the things that human beings within the framework of the church want to do, but his expressed and known will in the Word of God that he has described of signs and wonders and miracles, the demonstration of his glory, of his power, Holy Ghost conviction on a level to where that every one of the people that are in the church are moving in the gifts of the Spirit in such a way that anyone who walks in falls down on their knees. That's called Holy Ghost conviction. That's what happened in Charles Finney's meetings. That's what happened in many of Wigglesworth's meetings. And that's what we want to see happen in these meetings right here in the Abiding Place.
Amen.
I'm going to tell you right now, some of the greatest moves of God that I've ever seen in churches is when there's 10 or 15 people there that are absolutely sold out to God. Greatest anointings.
Then other people come along, and then they would just, they don't want to cooperate. They've got some kind of offense. They've got some kind of axe to grind. They've got some kind of disagreement, and they try to impose it on the meeting. They try to impose it on the meeting. They take their thoughts and their mental ascent and the mental power of man and the spiritual power of man that resides within his own human structure and makeup, and they impose it upon the meeting, resisting God, resisting the Holy Ghost. It's true. It's like a break in a power line. Or if it's not a break in a power line, it's like, you know, a cable that's got some of the insulation stripped off, and now the signal's weak. It's similar to that. And the reality of it is the Lord wants us to deal with it. I want you, and the best way for us to deal with it is if I can address these things to you in a context like we have here tonight, of going into a new year, a time where the Lord is constantly, He is constantly involved in and participating with those new beginnings. Like I said, the new year of Passover, you think about it, that is the beginning of the year. Exodus chapter 12, verse 2, this will begin the beginning of year. This will begin the beginning of months for you in the year. All of that, seeing that new beginning that we see in Christ Jesus, He said, "Behold, I've created a new heaven and a new earth, and your seed will remain before me forever. And we understand that, you know, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are new, and all things are of God. We recognize that we are the seed that God has called in Isaac. We are the seed of the promise. We're that seed that is not after necessarily after flesh, because we see the data's in against the people. You know, if somebody from the Haredi or Orthodox Judaism, if they wanted to debate me, the first thing I would say, if I was debating someone from Orthodox Judaism, I'd say, I'm going to prove to you that you're wrong before we ever get started, that you're on the wrong side before we ever get started, because every person like you in the Bible rejected God's prophets and His holy men and rejected God outright. And then I would, yeah, that's right, and I would begin, I'd just go ahead, just to make it easy, I'd begin with Moses, because that would be his context. There's just a defiance, a refusal to hear and to listen. But here God has given to us His place. And unfortunately, we see that too much in the church. You know, too much hardness of heart. Too many people wanting to do it their own way. They don't listen to God's fresh movings, His new beginnings. He said, "I've started all new for you. I've started all new for you. This beginning in Christ Jesus, it's everything is new. I've established it new. I've created, as it were, a new heaven for you." In other words, it's the same spiritual framework that was in the days of Daniel doesn't exist right now. People, we don't have to fast for 21 days to get Michael to come and help, or get Gabriel to come and help Michael so that the word could get through. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
It's just a clear, open channel of connection. Father's looking. He's in it right now. Father's in this right now. He's looking at your responses right now, because I know the encounter I had with Him before I got here. I know what He said before I even got here. He's trying you right now. He sees right now whether you're making heaven or where you're spending an eternity in hell. And it really has a lot to do with your responses to His word over and over again. I'm going to get low, personally. I'm going to get down on the ground. Hallelujah. I'm going to get down on the ground. I'm going to say, "Have mercy on me, God. I want it your way. Your way is life. I know you not got any compromises going on. I know that you're not cutting new deals. You cut the last one when you cut Christ Jesus at Calvary. You cut the last deal. Hallelujah. You forever perfected them that are sanctified, you that are set apart in Christ Jesus. You made us a new creation. Everything is brand new. And God expects it to be on the level that He made it to be, that He's decreed it to be. Look at what God has decreed in the New Testament, that we now are in Christ Jesus. That is His will. If we're not conformed to it, what are we doing, people? What are we doing? Got to get real.
Yeah.
And so every time there was a new moon, God wanted it once again. I want you to come. It was even more important than Sabbath, the new moon. And so every 11th month, you're having a New Year's celebration of just, you know, looking and praising God and shouting to God that you were kept by His mercies that are new every morning, and looking forward to the great things that He's going to do tomorrow. Are you looking forward to the great things that He's going to do tomorrow? Are you overwhelmed with doubt and unbelief that's got you imprisoned into some kind of place where God can't even, well, He can barely talk it to you, and every day it's getting less that you're hearing Him? Think about it. If you allowed yourself to get locked into a prison where all of a sudden the things that God has said and declared in His word are not real to you, and you're not pursuing them, and you're not contending for the faith that was once delivered unto saints. If you're not, then you're not part of His building, and you're not part of His husbandry, period. You look at how he labors for his building, and for his husbandry. You look at the amount of effort, the amount of passion, the amount of intercession, the amount of work, the amount of grace. Come on, people. I know we've made cleaning our house and doing our laundry and doing our dishes and going and, you know, doing our little jobs that amount to really nothing. As so important, because that's where we get our food from, our daily bread. But that's all a lie. It's all a deception. Our daily bread don't come from there. Father gives us our daily bread. And your job should be a mission field. Huh? And if you can't stay awake in the meeting, do the laundry after a church service. Clean your house after the church service. People wear themselves out. You know, you spend their best on themselves and give God something lame. You know, one-eyed attention. 1/16th mask. That's kind of Malachi. Take your lame offering. You promised me your best. And then when you showed up here, you gave me your one-eyed lame bull. Your one-eyed lame bull that got attacked by the wolves and lost a leg. And that's what you sacrificed it to me. Come give that to the governor and see if that's what is acceptable unto him. The one the wolves tore apart. You barely saved the thing. You nurtured it back to life just to bring it to me. Because it's of no value or use to you or anyone else. So you give it to me. You're giving me your leftovers. Listen, I'm telling you right now, it wasn't going good for the people that Malachi was addressing. And it's not going for, it's not going, we want to just make it an offering, a monetize it. People, it's bigger than some. The Lord's not impressed with your dollar bills. He's not impressed with Ben Franklin. He's not impressed with any of it. He's impressed with our heart. He wants our heart. You think he needs any money? He needs money as much as he needs a sacrifice. The cattle on 1,000 hills belong to him. Well, who cares about it? Another, you're bringing me another bull. You're bringing me another heifer. You're bringing me another sheep. You're bringing me another goat. It has nothing to do with it. It's about your heart that you recognize, wait a minute, you're bringing this innocent victim as a representation of the redemption that I've provided for you. And an opportunity for you now to become innocent before me. And it causes you to rejoice and celebrate that there is nothing standing between you and I in this place of fellowship. But they lost that. And it became all the mess that we see and observe as the prophet Isaiah is prophesying. And even more so as we see when Jesus showed up. And we know what he did. We know what his reaction. He wasn't going, wow, church meeting is just amazing. It's amazing. People are hungry for God, seeking after God. No, he makes a whip. He makes a whip. You know, I have to ask myself, Lord, would you come into the meeting and make a whip here? Have you ever even asked the Lord? Lord, if you came into the meeting that I was in, would you make a whip? Or would you join in? A lot of people don't even want to be that real. They already got their mind made up that, you know, that they are already high and lifted up and their train fills the temple right along with the Lord. You know what I'm saying? They've already got their mind made up. They would have never been with John, Lord, as it I. But examination of our hearts and of our lives are very important. And it's not a condemnation thing. It's just an analysis. It's an evaluation thing. It really comes down to just saying, getting a checkup. And if you don't like this kind of checkup, don't you ever go get yourself a physical ever again from a doctor. Getting a physical. I don't want to check up. Why don't you tell me what's wrong with me? If there's something wrong with me, just leave me alone. Just leave me alone. Let me die in peace. Let me die thinking I'm healthy. No. It's an evaluation, because if there's not hunger, if there's not passion, there's something spiritually wrong. Let God examine you. I mean, our heart's cry should be, Lord, let the floodlight of heaven shine upon my soul. Lord, see if there be anything in me that's wrong, anything that is in me that's wicked, anything that is me in my life that is out of order. And lead me in the way everlasting. Oh God, let the righteous smite me. Lord, let Pastor Mark get on my case in public. And there's very few people to pray that. They go to a meeting, prophet's going to be there. Oh God, I pray in the name of Jesus that if there's anything wrong with me, it will be publicly revealed. Show it to the prophet right now. If there's anything that's going on in my life that I somehow don't get it, and I'm cheating on you, and I've been deceived somehow, I've been led in the wrong way, oh God, I want that publicly revealed.
That's awesome.
Well, that's revival. That is revival. In all the revivals, go read about it. All the revivals, one of the earmarks of revivals is people who are hiding in sin and playing the hypocrite and acting like that they knew God better than everybody else. The stubborn people who wouldn't listen, acting like they were head and shoulders above everyone else spiritually, standing up and confessing their sins before the presence of the Lord, saying, I have been the problem. I've been the leaven. I've been the person that has been the Achan in the camp. I mean, just radical stuff. Revivals. Moves of God. Why? Because people got to get right. People got to publicly get right. Yes. You got to publicly get right. Yes. Isn't it about just coming down the altar call and repeat after me? That's not revival. Publicly getting right. Because, man, when you're willing to stand up and confess your sins in public, come on. Well, whatever was going on, there's something real happening. It isn't just done for self-serving purposes. Huh? Now, if you even have a word of knowledge that even possibly in any way brings any kind of despairing remark upon an individual, you are the worst thing that was ever born. No. This is God's way. You the men. You the woman. You need to get right. He tells us, this is what Father tells us to do. This is what Papa tells us to do, people. This is what Papa tells us. Don't get all upset at the men and women of God that are doing their job. Not if you're real, and not if you're serious about eternity. Not if you're serious about being right with God. And for me, I have a deeper desire than just being right with God. I have a desire to be fully used by Him. I have a bigger desire than to be fully used by Him. I have a desire to live in the glory of His presence, where I am so overpowered by His goodness that captivates every dimension of my thoughts, of my thinking, of my action, of my behavior, of my decision making. I like the whole idea that the Holy Spirit has come to bring to me everything that belongs to the Father. I want to get on the receiving end. I'm excited about the whole notion that He's come to show me things that eyes could not see. I want to see it. Cause me to hear things that ears cannot hear. I want to hear Him. To cause me to understand what's never entered into the hearts of men, but He's showing to us these things by the Holy Ghost. I want that. To understand how to be led every step, every decision, every action. To just wait, to listen more, not just to speak less. To just wait, because if you just listen long enough, you're going to hear right what's going on. You're going to hear. You're going to hear it. You're going to hear where people are at. You're going to hear what God feels about it. You're going to hear the direction of the Lord. You're going to understand how to sort the thing out. And then it just keeps getting bigger. I want to be in the know with what Father is about to do, because He says that He's not going to do anything unless He first reveals it unto His servants, the prophets. And I've thought, well, my goodness, what if there's no servants, the prophets? Then He's not going to be able to do much. If He doesn't do anything unless He first reveals it to the servants, the prophets, and the prophets first prophesy it and proclaim it and make it known, see it and declare it, and participate with it coming forth in the earth. And tonight, just to consider the reality that you get to be every one of you. I'm not leaving any one of you out. Because if I were leaving anyone out, I would have just stayed only on just the very rich and positive, glorious things that are for everybody who's in the right. But because I want to leave anybody out, I'm going to get everybody who's even borderlining on the wrong. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Much more those who are in the wrong. Let tonight be the beginning of something that is absolutely new in your life. And it's new in your life because you let go of your baggage. You let go of your stuff. Let me tell you how to do that. Repentance. True repentance. True repentance that applies the blood of Jesus Christ and the work of divine grace makes every, behold, I make all things new. Behold, Revelation 21 sings out, behold, I make all things new. It's not just once that the Lord does it. He does it for you tonight. It's the new creation. It's the work of divine grace. It's a wonderful privilege that we have when the blood of Jesus Christ is applied. If we sin, if there becomes a mark, if there becomes a stain, if there becomes a stronghold of offense, unforgiveness, some kind of improper dynamic to a relationship. It's an improper dynamic to a relationship for a wife not to listen to her husband, not to be under the authority of her husband, to have an accusation against her husband where she doesn't trust him. You understand what I'm saying? That is a serious problem. The thing is spiritually out of order. It is spiritually messed up when people in the congregation don't reverence the pastor and the ministers that the Lord's put before them. That's even worse messed up than a woman saying that she doesn't trust her husband, or a husband saying he doesn't trust his wife. It's messed up. What is that? That's a demonic stronghold that has totally messed up the order of relationship and the dynamics of the way that God has put the order of things together. It's like the sun not coming up in the morning. The order of things all together is all messed up. It's like the tide coming in and it keeps coming in. Or going out and it keeps going out. It's messed up. It's out of order. You wouldn't want that kind of out of order. Huh? If there's anything in your life that is not in alignment and agreement with what God said in His Word, if it doesn't look like the love of Jesus Christ, where you're willing not only to forgive it, but to go and be a sacrificial offering on its account, then you want to get that right. You don't want to cheat and pretend and cover it over and put a nice little dress on it or whatever and justify it, make it right when it's wrong, because you never get to move forward with God. You never get to go into the new because you voluntarily, by your own will, said, I'm going to stay in the old. I'm not going into your new. I'm not allowing everything to be new, clean, fresh, new start. Father gives us a new start every morning if we want it. The problem isn't with the people who want it. The problem is with the people who are not willing to receive it. They want to live in the old. They want to live in the hurt. They want to live in their accusation, their complaint. And you know what? The reality of it is, that is the pride of life extraordinaire, because that, by definition, believes that you have all insight, all wisdom to execute the correct judgment on what you thought happened, or the events, or what you believe caused the events that occurred. And you don't have that. Wake up. Shake yourself. Slap yourself around. Huh? You know, when we're falling asleep driving, we roll down the window and put our head out the window. Especially if it's raining. It wakes you. It's cold rain. It'll wake you right up. Wake you right up. Whatever it takes. But the relationship with the Lord should be so intimate that all of those things are unveiled and revealed right there in the moment of prayer. Because you're touching heaven every day. People, if I wasn't touching heaven every day, I know layers could come on me. If I wasn't allowing the flow of the Holy Ghost to bust out of me, I know things could begin to stop up this well. I mean, I know how important it is to be able to touch heaven and heaven touch you every day, to where there's an explosion of divine glory and divine power, where the light of His presence and the light of His glory is there and nothing is hid and everything is exposed before Him with whom you have to do. Because at that moment, you can just lay it aside. You can get right. You can start blessing everybody that even might have possibly cursed you. New Year's is a great time to send out blessings of text messages to everybody who's problematic in your life. Plus everybody who's blessed you. Just to bless the good and the evil. To let go of everything that's trying to hold you back into something that messed you up. Get back to the honor that you had in the first minute of meeting that person. Get back to the love and the first that you had in the first minute of meeting that person. Get back to the value, the appreciation that you had in the first minute of knowing that person, and keep it. Yes. Get back to the same kind of divine order that was established for us in Christ Jesus, that He showed us in every expression that He made while He walked upon this earth, and demands that you and I come and follow Him. And if we're not willing to, He tells us we are not His disciples. God's called us to come and walk in the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost is going to express in our life the purity and the truth and the humility that was shown in Christ Jesus, because that's the only place of honesty. And when there's truth there, you're going to have more insight, because wisdom is going to show you. And as long as you think you know, you are held in the prison of deception, and what you know is nothing other than a lie. It is not truth. It is an imagination. It is a vain imagination that becomes an oppressive thing, a demonic stronghold that runs its rerun over and over again. And every rerun, it adds just a little bit more of a lie to make a complete different story than actually what happened. And every year it gets compounded effect. And the longer you wait to get this thing settled and get this thing dealt with by the blood of Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of God, the stronger the stronghold becomes, the greater the oppression becomes. I mean, I think that's a whole big part of grabbing a hold of the mercies that are new every morning, of having a new beginning every new moon, of having a new beginning every new year, of having a new beginning every new day, and ultimately every new hour. Come on. Yeah, because the Lord God brought the new beginnings into every second of our life when He said, you can be forgiven 490 times a day. He brought a new beginning into every second of our life. Clearly, every minute of our life, but truly, the value of it is every second of our life. Because every second of our life, there's the opportunity to have a new beginning by forgiveness and repentance. But if you're not willing to do it, if you're going to hold a grudge, if you're going to hold on to somebody, if you're going to count somebody's sin, somebody's wrongdoing, and usually I'm going to tell you right now, when you're counting somebody's sin or wrongdoing, it never happened. It's a lie. It's a deception. And it wouldn't be in your life if it wasn't a lie and deception, because you would already be free from it as one of God's people. It becomes a stronghold because it was a lie and deception. Everything you know about it, everything you believe about it was a demonic stronghold. It was a demonic assignment against you. It was something that you allowed to take hold of you. It's oppressed you from that very moment, and it's time to get free. God over and over again is calling us every second of the day to have a new beginning. And this is just a microscopic, that's the microscopic level. This is the macroscopic level. This is the big ordeal. This is the big event. And that's why it's the best thing to do is to humble yourself and fasting and praying and seeking the Lord right here at the moment of this new beginning. And to stop counting your new beginnings as something that is just ordinary and nothing to get too excited about, other than a little shout and a little party on, you know, 2 or 3 hours on one night. And it has nothing to do with God, and it has nothing to do with change. Because everybody's making New Year pledges, and they're going to do this, and they're going to do that, and they're not. It's going to last. It's going to last for just a very short period of time. Discipline is a beautiful thing, but only God's people really have it. Amen. Discipline is a beautiful thing. It creates beautiful things. For many people, it's become an ugly word. But praise God for the person who set up that piano and disciplined until they learned how to play every key properly, and they began to go beyond the boundaries of what everybody else played and their sheet music. And their sheet music took them through pressing in to another dimension, to where that now they could take all that they knew and begin to create something new. All that they learned and begin to create something new. Praise God for the artist that gives themselves painstakingly to so many hours of learning the color mix and learning how to lay the foundations, and all of the knowledge and information that they received as they studied and they gave themselves to learning. And then all of a sudden they broke a barrier where it wasn't about learning anymore, and they stepped out beyond what everything that they were taught, and something new comes into existence. Praise God for discipline. It creates such beautiful things. Praise God for the people who give themselves to the study of the Word at every dimension of the Word, in every part, every language, every way that it can be examined, every way that it can be looked at, every way that it can be handled, every way that it can be touched, to take it personally. That's not something that's an intellectual, but it's a heartfelt thing of touching God, knowing God, because there's something so beautiful that comes out of it, something that creates for us a whole new opportunity of understanding and revelation in God, in Christ Jesus. Come on. Praise God for those who give themselves to masteries, who want to become skillful in the things of the Spirit, who recognize, wait a minute, God's given me an opportunity to go beyond that which Elijah did, to go beyond that which Daniel had, to go beyond that even which Jesus manifested. I can begin to learn how to move in the gifts of healing. I'm going to give myself to it every day. I'm going to shout to every mountain, grace, grace, that tries to stand in my way. I'm going to give myself the development of all of these things that the Spirit of the Lord has made available to me. He's my master, and he wants to give me the skill set to do it most perfectly. Praise God for the discipline. And it's all found, really, those things are all found, really, in learning how to talk with him. Learning how to step beyond that which the five senses impose upon us and go over into another realm and begin to see that there is far more with us than are with them. There's far more going on than what we were ever able to recognize in the past. I'm not captivated by the five senses anymore. Something else has grabbed a hold of my being. And suddenly what begins to come on the forefront is spiritual senses that I never knew I had. The ability to hear the Holy Ghost speak. To be Sharapa, to be Gili Patorasina, to be Gitastina, to be Gidambrustai, to begin Mistilim Batutara, begin Antupon, to begin Shipa, to see into the realms of the heavenlies and understand what Father is doing so it can do it with them. That's what this is about. This isn't 21 days of starving yourself. And I know misery loves comfort. So don't sit around and talk to each other about how much you ate and didn't eat and how many days you fasted and how many hours you've gone. Don't even do it, because I'm telling you, it compromises that. It compromises that. Compromises it, huh? Don't even, come on. Your wife, she wants to know, because she's like a mom. You know, I tell my wife all the time, you know, she has five kids. One will never leave home. She's stuck with one. I went by her closet and I looked in her closet and it's like perfection. It's like perfection. I'm like, this woman is so just, I go to my closet and it's like, I immediately started organizing and cleaning things up. Like looking at her spiritual life and then going to look at mine. Jesus. Hers was so perfect. Where I messed up is that I have this laundry basket that somehow I convinced myself that I have no responsibility for at all. It is sad. It's sad. I'm just confessing my sins that I shouldn't be getting. And I don't hit the mark every time on that laundry basket. And so things are hanging over the side. Because I've downloaded that entire responsibility to my dear wife. And she has graciously taken up that responsibility. I mean, I'm so sorry. I did her clothes one time. And when I told her that I did laundry by texture, she decided to take the job. She said, how do you sort these things out? I said, by texture. She goes, no, 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 no. You know, guys are not that dumb. We just act like it because it's a job that we do. But I was that dumb. I thought it was maybe sense. It made sense. You know, if it's rough, it ought to go together. If it's smooth, it ought to go together. Oh, wrong logic. We have a lot of that in a lot of different ways of wrong logic. I pray tonight in Jesus' mighty name that you'll grab a hold of the fact that every second's a new opportunity of a new beginning. But you've got to be willing to cooperate with the new. You have to be willing to live the whole old behind. Behold, I make all things new. What a wonderful. Behold, I make a new heaven and earth. The Lord did it all by himself. He says, who's in with me? Who's going with me? Who's in? Who's in? I got this whole thing. I just put this whole thing together. This is all brand new. Are you in?
Yeah.
He said, behold, I make all things new. New creation, a new heart. All that matters to the Father. All these other things don't even matter. He says, a new creation is all that matters to me. Are you into the new? I'm going to forget about the old. The old I remember no more. I put it far away from me. This is what he says over and again from Isaiah chapter 62 all the way through the New Testament. The old, I don't want to hear about the old. Don't tell me about the old. I'm not interested in the old. Don't tell me about what happened last year. Don't tell me what happened yesterday. I don't want to hear about it.
I want to hear about how you betrayed me. I don't want to hear about how you committed treason against me. I don't want to hear about how you defied my whole thing. I don't want to hear about it. It's done. It's over. Come on. Let's get into the new. Let's have some fun. Let's do this thing. Let's get out of the condemnation. Let's get out of the assault. Let's get out of the shame. Let's get out of the misery. Don't sit here and talk about the bad stuff. Let's talk about the good stuff. Oh, but I need to process. No, apply the blood. I'll break the curse. I will move out of you in the name of Jesus. That's the remedy. That's the remedy. What you talk about is what you create. Talking is about creating. Talking is not about destroying. Talking is about creating. It's not about annihilating. It's about creating. Quit talking about those things that you don't want to have in your life.
Oh, I can remember that time when you gave me the cycling look. I can remember it. Just like it was yesterday.
I did what? I gave you a what?
An ugly look.
What?
Another look.
An ugly look. I did. What did that look like? Oh, yeah, that was the day I was sick to my stomach. You never know. You don't know. We put all these things of vain imaginations. It's a great enemy, people. Can you imagine going in to stand before the presence of God, the judgment seat of the Lord Jesus Christ, and your whole hang up was something that didn't even ever happen? It just destroyed your whole relationship with the Lord, and it never even happened. Could annihilate the stuff with the blood of Jesus Christ and prophesy every good thing. And go ahead and talk to God about everybody you think is bad and talk to them about on the level that they are good. And begin to talk to them if somehow you think that somehow they got some problem with you. If there's any offense, if you think that somebody doesn't love you, don't want to see you, I'm going to tell you right now that's an oppressive, lying thing. Get yourself in the realms of the anointing so you're oh so overwhelmed with the goodness and the glory of God, you go up and give everybody a kiss. Instead of walking around them. See, you're walking down the hall and you see somebody and they're walking towards you and suddenly they slip into another room and you know exactly why they slipped in that other room. They ain't slipping in the other room because that's where they were headed. They slipped in the other room because you was walking towards them. And self-consciousness overwhelmed them. And a sense of inferiority. And a lot of times it's a sense of rejection. It's fear. Fear's got torment. It messes everything up. Get over here in the love. Get up in the morning. It's new every morning. And get yourself a humbodaramaneataya and build yourself up in your most holy faith so you can step over the love of God. And it don't matter. You don't live under fear anymore. You're not intimidated anymore. You don't feel rejected anymore. You people look at you and go, who does she think she is? Who does she think she is? She's so bold and confident shouting out orders around here like she's the one who designed it all. Yeah, partners with God. Come on, people. It's a wonderful thing. It's a wonderful thing to be able to properly raise your kids where they grow up and they don't have fear and intimidation, sense of rejection, inferiority. At the same time, they're walking in humility and they're reverent and respectful. I mean, come on, only God can show us how to do these kinds of things. But you got to participate with him so he can show your children through you. Come on. Think about it. How many times did I keep you out of church? Huh? How many times? I think I can remember one time we had church. We weren't in church. We were in Yellowstone. And I gave all of you little instruments, and we had church right there isn't that true? In that little house. That's about it. And that's the difference. Some people just flippity-floppity with it, I think, you know? Oh, God, you know, you just like the workplace or you just like any other place. We're going to go, no. You need to live disciplined, consecrated lives and make what God has placed before us and the opportunities that he's given something that's so sacred, so wonderful, it is never compromised for any reason, for anything. As my mama used to say, come hell or high water, we there. We there and with smiles. Amen. And everybody who doesn't have a smile gets spanking. You choose. Smile or spanking. Huh? Obedience is better than sacrifice. You better obey because you will be the sacrifice. Ha, 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 ha. Ha, ha, ha. Hallelujah. Come on. Come on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's one of the first things I taught little Anna when she stayed with me the first time. Anna, obedience is better than sacrifice. The instrument of sacrifice is hanging right there on the water fountain. That was the belt. That's the instrument of sacrifice.
It will go across your behind with great pain. It will create a humility in your life through an affliction.
I will afflict you so that you'll be humble and obey. Think about it. I'm talking to you. Hope you can connect the dots. Thank you, Father, for your goodness.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Well, I was just going to do some short announcements there, and I got a bit carried away. Praise God. Praise the name of the Lord. You know, I want to spend some time just shouting to the Lord, just shouting to Him in a way that only the Holy Ghost can produce in our life. I want you to think about this. Not shouting because it's just, you know, what we got to do tonight, or just, but shouting in such a way of thanksgiving and of praise of what God you have done for us, that you kept us safe this far, yeah, that you brought us to this place. So many times I could have lost my life. So many times the Lord spared my life. So many times. Over and over and again, times that I know and times that I don't know. One night I was riding, I was 16 years old. I'll never forget it. I was in a van. I had my head sticking out the window looking out the van. I decided in my thinking, I pulled my head back in, and there was a spear. It was a limb that had been cut off in a spear sticking right. It would have gone right through my head. I mean, it was just one of those shocking things. It's just like, over and again, Father has spared our lives. Every person in this place. Over and again, He has shown His mercy and His grace and His long-suffering and His favor, and He's not given up on us, and He won't give up on us, and He pleads us, and He draws us with cords of loving kindness and tender mercy, and He forgives us, and He doesn't want to talk about the failure and the sin and the shame. He just erases it because we're willing to allow Him to erase it. He brings us to a place where we're willing to cooperate fully with Him. He does this by continually working with us. I mean, that's got to turn into a shout of some point. You've got to turn into a shout at some point in our lives. And you begin to set preference, you begin to set precedence for it at a beginning. You got to have a beginning. And somewhere in the beginning, you said, this is what I'm going to do. And now this is the beginning that I want. This is the life that I want. And now I'm going to follow through. And it's not going to just be a beginning. It's going to be something that I do continually. It's ongoing. And this is how I'm going to live my life. And then all of a sudden, we begin to think, wait a minute, the one who's kept me thus far will keep me all the way unto that day, that He will perfect everything that concerns me, that He's my author and my finisher. That He who began a good work in me will complete the work. All I got to do is be willing to cooperate. Oh God, I want to cooperate, Father. Strengthen me to cooperate. I'm yours. You're so good to me, Lord. Father, I'm yours. Lord, thank you for your goodness, and thank you for your mercy, and thank you for this year. Thank you for the great things that you've done. Oh, Sabai Hayalabo. Dear people, you know, I want you to set such a precedence in your life to where that, you know, you're not willing to have anything other than a Holy Ghost meeting. And that precedence and that desire and that demands place upon your own life first. And it's not somehow put on someone else, put on me or anyone else. You place it on your own life. I cannot live without a Holy Ghost meeting. With a greater encounter with God, and it's something that you demand. And because when every one of us come in with that kind of demand, and we have a single heart, well, now we're not looking for cues from everybody else. We're looking for cues from the Lord alone. I've got to have you, God. I've got to have an encounter. There has got to be something more of you in my life. I'm not going to live in what I've had up to this point when you've opened up the door to every dimension of your fullness. I've got to lay hold on these things, Father. I'm going to get a firm grip. And I'm going to fight the fight that is necessary to fight for the things that are coming out against me to stop me from having what you've demanded and what God has demanded. He supplied the ability to achieve, to do it. And when we recognize that there's no way of giving up, there's no way of letting up.
And dear people, I mean, I'd be remiss to say, to not highlight the reality that, you know, Ann was pointing out to me today, you know, as you know, we're putting another event on the calendar, going to another place that we've never been before, up into Alaska. And she said, honey, we actually ran harder this year than we have in an entire married life, which would then be harder than we've ever run in our lives, because we've definitely run harder together than we ran before we were married. And, you know, I'm just thinking about all the things that God did, all the places that the Lord sent us, all the things that you guys partnered with us to establish. I mean, I'm telling you, if we just look at the one event of getting the steel building down on the ground in Bly, I'm telling you, that shook the ground. I'm telling you, it shook the ground of Oregon. I promise you, it shook the ground. It shook the ground of a stronghold. There's places nearby where people have prophesied over that region for a long time. You know, God wants every place, every town, every village, every city to be, you know, to be touched with His glory, be touched with His power. But sometimes I think that the Lord has special places that He wants to move, because it's as though Satan has fortified the place against the move of God. You know, right down the street from where we've just set the laid out the building on the ground is where preachers tried to burn down the tent of Tommy Hicks. And what a great hero of the faith. Tommy Hicks is one of the great heroes of the faith. What Tommy, God did through Tommy Hicks. He sets his tent up. They tried to burn it down just, you know, maybe like 20 miles from where the building is. There's so many things like that, so many crazy things that have happened in that area. People prophesied of the area that's just up from the church about 20 miles the other way, about 20, 30 miles the other way in Bonanza, of things that God was going to do. And, you know, it's just, it's an event. And every one of you labored, and some of you had to strain because it was an intensity to try to lay hold on finances to do that. It's not done yet. But we're going to get it done in the name of Jesus.
Yes,
I mean,
amen.
Some other things have happened where we just, you know, we had to hire an engineer, specialized engineer, because they classified it as a commercial building. And so, you know, but we're getting it done. I mean, we're pushing the thing through. You know, just the places that we were able to go and come back, and you're still here. You know, when I'm gone for long stretches of time, you don't have me on Wednesday night at all. I'm coming in as much as I can on Sunday morning, Sunday nights, which I'm committed to doing. And you're here, and you just faithfully pursue the things of the Spirit. You don't allow strife. You don't allow envy. You're able to recognize and discern the tricks of the enemy that is there to stop the flow of God, and you give no place to the devil. I mean, come on. The things that you helped us do this year, Kashmir, you know, Cuba, I mean, just the India. Just the list goes on. And I can't even think of all of it, but reality of it is we did it together. And I couldn't have done it without you. And I pray in the name of Jesus that you will allow it to be multiplied to where that you say, wait a minute, you know, I'm going to give myself to more fervent prayer, because I recognize now better than I did in 2016 that prayer is an authority that changes things on another level. I'm going to give myself to recognizing that God is going to take and multiply the finances, that I can step out into a whole other dimension of faith and watch as God works the miracle. I can lay hold on great supernatural financial provision when all my idea of finances is about how we can see the nation of America shaken and the places around the world. I mean, we're going places this year that we've never been to. We're going to Switzerland. We're going to Finland. We're going to Alaska. And then we haven't even gotten into the year yet. And back to Kashmir. And of course, I'm believing that the Lord is going to supernaturally supply things in the realms of finances, as also in the realms of, you know, prayer support and open doors that go beyond this us here at this church. But you know what? You can do it all. We can do it all.
Amen.
And the reality of it is, it's never, and don't ever think that it's an exchange, because it's not. It isn't an exchange. It isn't an exchange. It's the participation to take all that God has made us and given us and saying, Lord, it's all yours.
Amen.
Let's do this.
Yes.
Let's do this. Lord, can I do greater things than this?
Yes.
Okay, have you asked the Lord, Lord, can I do greater things than I'm doing? Yes. Have you said, Lord, I know you want me to do greater things than I'm doing?
Yes.
Have you said, Lord, I'm desperate to do greater things than I'm doing?
Yes.
Okay, so, you know, you think about it. First of all, you got to start with where you're at. And say, I want to do greater things than I'm doing. Not even getting into Jesus. Works. Right? And greater works. You're just starting about greater things than what you're doing right now. Because if you're not willing to do greater things than what you're doing right now, you're not going to connect the dots properly. Are you with me?
Yes.
You're going to be waiting for a day. Come on. It's like step up. Listen, Lord. I want to open my mouth in 2017 and speak the word in due season. I want to speak the word for 2017 that shakes and vibrates everything in the atmosphere with your glory, with your power, that has nothing of me in it, that has no compromising, that has no compromise, that there's no compromise in me. Because if there's any compromise in me, it certainly is going to somehow hinder the flow of your uncompromising voice, the utterance of your uncompromising voice. Hallelujah. 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 Lord, I want to lay hold on your manifest presence like I've never understood. I've walked around so overwhelmed by the presence of the Lord for days. Just overwhelmed by his glory, overwhelmed by his presence. Where it would be very difficult to speak in the English language. Well, I want more of that on a greater intensity, and a greater intensity with a greater manifestation of the power and the glory of the Father revealed through my life. Come on, Father wants us to be able to see. Yes. He wants us to be able to see clearly what's about to happen. He wants us to get our news right from Him and quit being distracted with what CNN says and going and repeating what CNN said or what Fox News said. Both of them are vile. They both are vile. I can say one thing. At least CNN does more programs about Jesus. They do. They do more programs about Jesus. This Christmas, they did more programs about Jesus. Fox did none. They did few. CNN did two or three. I mean, people's balance is just all messed up. But forget about it. It doesn't matter. We go lay out all the evidences and supports. Everybody's a liar except for God. Amen. It's a false report except for what God's saying. But if I'm captivated by that, and I'm saying, oh, this is what's going to happen. This is what's happening over there, and this is what's happening over here, and this is doing this, and who's doing that. Then I'm, you know what? So the Lord says, you're a know-it-all. So you already know. I don't need to tell you anything. And that's what happens. It happens to us. We get all consumed with what we know, and there's no room to hear. We get all consumed with what we know, and there's no room to hear. But if all of a sudden we push all this out, no. 21 days, don't listen to the news. Yeah. Like, come on, please, would you please pray? You can do that. Yeah. That ain't going to cost you no stomach ache. Probably save you a stomach ache. Huh? Don't watch the news. It's 21 days, just 21 days. You probably like it so much at the end of 21 days, you probably feel so clean and so free, you may never go back. You may never go back. And when you go back, you will go back with like, oh, she got to be kidding me. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Prasutanama sikhisindalala mahopra. The sickness business. We just want the thing shut down in 2017.
Amen.
I'm on Resana. I want something better. I want something better than a strong immune system. Come on. I want something better than having to teach your kids not to pick their nose. No, I'll tell you right now. We could get into the hygiene things that we watch go on around here, but I don't even want to get into it. I want something better than having to teach people some basic manners. Okay? I want a supernatural moving of God. Now, you touch any deadly thing, it won't hurt you. I don't care who's walking around with every kind of virus, infliction, and disease on them. Try, you know, basically, you know, be a test tube for sickness and disease. A place of inoculation. I want to shut that thing down. Come on. I want to shut the thing down. Somebody said, we need to wipe the knobs more. Listen, I'm telling you right now, let's grab a hose something to take care of better. It's better than wiping the knobs down. It's better than cleaning the toys. We're going to blame it all on the kids. Let's lay hold of a realm of faith. I mean, if we got an explanation for it, it's going to shut down faith. It's going to shut down faith. The moon. He's acting this way because of the moon. And that's what they were telling the disciples. And the disciples start, Jesus coming, it's the moon. No. Jesus coming, what are you guys talking to my disciples about? Because they're like going, oh, it's the moon. Because it's been working. The name of Jesus has been working everywhere else. I mean, devil's been going out just as soon as we say anything. Here we are. We're trying to cast this devil out. Nothing's happening. It's the moon, Jesus. Jesus is like, get you perverse generation. Get out of my way. Stand back over here. You scribes and Pharisees, shut up. Disciples, get back. Get over here. Come out. And they say, well, why couldn't we do that? And he's helping them first understand what he say. He helps them understand. These kind come out by fasting and praying. But reality of it is, he was also having to deal with the fact that they were bogged down with what they believed was the problem. And they've got a whole description, a whole, you know, etymology of, you know, whole history of how it came into being and why it's continuing on. There's no faith can work in that realm. What if it's not something you can see under a microscope? What if it is something that looks like about, you know, just, it's a demon spirit. It's a demon spirit. Ha, fooled you again. Thought it was because you didn't wipe the knobs. Ha, ha. Thought it was because you didn't disinfect the toys. Ha! Fooled you again. All you had to do is say, you foul spirit of sickness and disease, I got your number. I see you right now. I'll kill you right now. Amen. Destroy your power right now. Disseminate in Jesus' name. Amen. Cease to exist. Hallelujah. 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 I have no evidence to believe that a demon spirit's supposed to be internal anyways. It ceased to exist in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. You foul spirit of hell. Hallelujah. I destroy you now. I learned that from a very good mentor. You foul spirit of hell. I destroy you now. Carlos Anagondia. You foul spirit of hell. I just not render you powerless. I destroy you. Fasting and prayer take you into that and believing that is a reality and seeing it. Amen. I tell you right now, these kind come out by fasting and prayer because you move beyond those things that are imposing upon your physical senses and giving you explanations that are not true and keeping you from moving into the dimensions of faith, holding you within the boundaries of that which is only humanly possible. Come on, break the boundary. There's a place to go. We can break the boundary. Somebody said, how about this one? How about that one? They love the Lord. I don't care about this one and that one. They love the Lord and that whatever. And they didn't get there. I'm talking about what Jesus said and what God made available to and what he's commanded us to have. And it's time for us to step up and say, look, it isn't about years of service. It's about laying hold of things. Some of you don't even have to break through the doubts and the unbeliefs and the obstacles of religion that I've had to deal with. Because you came in as a, you know, just a clean slate into the kingdom of God. And filled was no sooner born again as you were filled with the Holy Ghost. Huh? You can get there, you can go now, you can just lay hold on these things. 2017, the Lord sets us up as a new beginning. He opens up the door before us as a new beginning. If we receive it as all new, we get to participate with every dimension of the new. And there needs to be shoutings. And there needs to be praises. And there needs to be thanksgiving. And there needs to be rejoicing in all of our prayer. In all of our action. And having it tonight. And having it tomorrow. And having a New Year's Eve tomorrow night, and then one the next night, and then the one the next day, and then ever the next day, and then everywhere His mercy's there, have a shout of praise, and every second that there is the opportunity of His forgiveness, rejoicing in His goodness. Should He not be praised and given thanks for being willing to every second of the day forgive us of such treason and iniquity? If we believe that He's forgiven us, shouldn't we then begin to rejoice in who He is and in His loving and His long-suffering and His gentleness and His goodness? And, oh my goodness, it's got to produce something more that can happen in our lives. Unfortunately, we ask God to forgive us and we're still in the rut of unbelief as though somehow we're still had it held against us and God don't want to talk about it no more. He wants us to go on with Him. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Praise the name of Jesus. Shoo! Hallelujah! Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. Thank you, Father, for the mercy, your goodness that leads us to repentance, your faithfulness to keep everything that we committed unto you. Oh God, your love that produces within our life your fruit. Oh God, your wonderful works, oh God, that will fulfill everything that you have begun in our life. You are amazing, oh God. We shout out praise unto your holy name. Santa Yerebeha, Santa Yerebeziha, Santa Lohoshika, Susana Yerebeha, Susana Lalabashi Prabayo Yabashika Romo, Sula Vataya Lamoshi Prabayo, Santa Yerebakusta Prabayo Bakaya. Oh, Father. Father, we thank you for making the Abiding Place Ministry a place of great glory, a place of great praise, a place of great fruitfulness in you. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that everybody in this place will discover a spiritual food, a heavenly meat to eat that the world and the human realm knows not of. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that we will lay hold upon a spiritual drink, Lord, that nothing in the realms of the human can understand, but it's purely divine, a place of fellowship with you, of breaking all the barriers of wrong motivations, of wrong attitudes, of wrong thinking, of human achievement, to grab a hold of knowing you and walking with you and seeing and beholding this One who has loved us with such an everlasting love, who has given such mercy and such grace. Sutaramaya sutaneya. Sutaramaya suparaneya pa. Sutaramaya promomaneya. Hallelujah. Hamre namango saramande yeshi. Halanda de besito do bahora. Haramba rabashi faro nomohore de kitandolo bahashika. Ere mamando roboshiti dandolo bokuri manda la la mashe prebebeheha. Usutara mandere me mangili ando sokori ni ashika. Mamana man a name running number usutaya. Hallelujah. I believe that even right now God is bringing to mind in some people's lives things that people maybe that you have not had the right attitude towards, you've not loved them like you should love them, you've not responded to them. Maybe you've held something a little against them. You say that you've forgiven them, but you've not really reached out to them and blessed them. Listen, take note of it and say, tell the Lord you're going to take care of that. Take note of it. Come on, that means, go ahead, let's just play a little bit. That means that's what that means. Hallelujah. Father, thank you for this night of new beginnings. Geneva, and is Geneva not in here? Honey, you and Kate, why don't you guys go over there and Elizabeth too, and start setting up the communion. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Our new year is nothing more but than a declaration to God and God alone for his goodness and for his faithfulness, for all that he has done for us, and all, and a declaration of certainty of all that he's going to do on our behalf, a blessed rejoicing in all that we've been able to know and understand at this point, and a great expectation for all the things that he's going to bring us into. And we're not going to sit by and just passively let it happen. We're going to actively and aggressively lay hold on things of God. And when you actively and aggressively lay hold on things of God, you don't have time for anything else. You don't have time for anything else. I tell you right now, actively and aggressively hanging on, holding on to God, laying hold of things of God is a full-time job. It's a full-time life occupation. Hallelujah. It'll consume every moment of your day, every part of your day. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you guys to just think about those people. It was their fault. It was their fault that you don't have the same relationship with them that you once had. And I want you to go ahead and get rid of whose fault it is. And I want you to lay everything aside and forgive it, and hallelujah. Bless them. Find a way to bless them. Whoever that may be, find a way to bless them. Set it in your heart right now that you're going to bless them. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Settle in your heart tonight that you're going to lay hold on these things that Father has brought to us by the Holy Ghost. I believe that if our response to the Lord is when we've been arrogant or when we've been haughty or when we've been short, we just say, Lord, Holy Spirit, I'm so sorry for stepping over you. I want to walk in your humility, in your brokenness. That right there is one of the most important things that connect us with being sensitive to being led by him. When we just catch ourselves in the midst of it. Wait a minute. What am I saying right now? I'm running somebody down. I'm talking ill of someone. Holy Spirit, I ask you to just forgive me for running right over top of you and taking my mouth and making it a profane thing when it's supposed to be a sacred thing. Lord, I ask you to forgive me for allowing my tongue to be set on fire of hell when it's supposed to be set on fire only of you. And what happens is that's a response to his correction that's already there. And he's not going to force us. He's just waiting for us to begin to live the word. He's just waiting for us to begin to speak the word and live the word. And recognize when we're stepping beyond what he's doing. And then because walking with him, I mean, one of the most important things of being used by God is being yielded to him. One of the most important things of being yielded to him is not violating the things that he's doing. Being yielded to him is being in a place where you're not violating his way and his nature. And one of the most important way that we grow and mature in that is just catching ourselves. Say, no, I'm not having that behavior. Shutting it down. It'd be good if you had somebody around you that could walk around you and slap you upside the head every time you act ugly. Every time you act wrong. But you get tired after that. You get tired of that after about the third time. You know, it's like getting ready to prepare to fast and pray when you're full. When you're full, you can fast for 40 days, no problem. You know? When you're right there in that place, I want to get this thing right. Yeah, let somebody come along and let the righteous smack me every time I open my mouth wrong. But as soon as you're engaged in the thing, you're in this thing a day. Well, really, it doesn't really kick into the third day. Your whole body starts slowing down. Unless it's grace. God will give you grace. Father can give you grace. Thank you, Jesus. And with this fast, I want you to let that be the key word, okay? That'll be the key word. So many of you got so many different things going on. Ann and I are moving right now. Somebody said, you're going to fast while you're moving? Yeah, I'm going to fast while I'm moving. Fortunately, I can, when I'm in my house moving, I can holler as loud as I want. I'm praying the Holy Ghost. I can shout. And I tell you, I just walk it out. I walk it out in grace. I just walk it out in grace. And then, don't put something on you yourself that is going beyond the grace. Just walk it out relationally with the Lord. Just walk it out relationally. You know, if, for example, when I'm fasting, a lot of times I can't go to sleep. When I'm fasting, I can't sleep. And so maybe late at night before I go to bed, sometimes I'll just take a little piece of bread. Just a little piece of bread. A little piece of bread. And I'm asleep. Sometimes I don't need that. I just walk it out. The bigger thing is the prayer. Give yourself the majority of the time, just give yourself no food and prayer. And then if the grace is there, you're sleeping well and you have the energy, hey man, praise God. It's supernatural. It's supernatural fast. And you'll, as you give yourself to fasting, you'll discover those. It's like, wow. I mean, I remember times like trying to get through one day, it was just torture beyond all imagination. Torture. High rate of metabolism, no fat to burn kind of thing. Torture. And then I broke through. And I could go for 2 days. 3 days was a big barrier, big mark. I'm just saying this. Dear people, walk it out. There's a bigger objective here. Laying hold on the things of the Spirit. You say, because you want it. Here, if I could distill it down into one concept, you really want to break the barriers of the five senses, of just living in the realms of the five senses and getting all of your cues from the five senses. You want to begin to hear what your ear can hear. You want to begin to function and operate in a realm where doubt and unbelief can't even exist. It's like dark trying to hang around in sunshine. It's a beautiful realm. It's a beautiful realm. When you begin to speak and you know it's as real to you, it's as real to you as if you would see him looking at you. You know Father's listening and hears you. It's as real as though you were talking to him face to face and he was responding. Going, yeah. I understand. It's a wonderful realm. And when you touch the realm, faith begins to work. And that's, I'm going to tell you, I mentioned this the other night. 20 years ago, a little over 20 years ago, I was throwing up. And I had been having this thing where stomach flus were hitting me. And I laid hold of a realm of faith in my desperation. And I said, this will never happen again. It was the gift of faith, and it's never happened again. I want to operate in that gift of faith all the time. But you know what? I'm glad I can look back and say, it happened there, it happened there, it happened there, it happened there. Well, I want it to happen more frequently. But I'm telling you, I'm giving you the key. When you're in a place of speaking to him, and you see that he's hearing. I mean, it's not just believing that he's hearing. You know it. So there's an interaction. It's a dynamic. You won't understand what I'm saying until you go there. I think some of you kind of can feel it a bit. But I want you to go there. And then let me help you. You know that you've been there because the gift of faith starts working. Okay? So, because sometimes we'll pretend. We'll say, well, I believe that about myself. And that's good. You should. You should believe the best. But when it happens, there's the outworking of the supernatural. And that's what we want. We want to see you function in the gift of faith. We want to see you function in the signs and the wonders and miracles of God that are there for all of us. There's a barrier to break. It's just a barrier. It's a doubt and unbelief barrier. Really, it's a five-sense realm barrier. It really is. Really is. It's breaking the barriers of those things that confine us in a human realm, in a human limitation, to begin to step into participation with the life of Jesus Christ and moving under the authority of the Word, that only the revelation of God can produce. You can't think it to yourself. You can't make yourself get there. This is nothing of human origin. It's a place of divine cooperation. You must understand this. People are always trying to bootstrap it, you know, grab themselves. I'm going to do this. I can do this. I know I can do this. I believe, I believe, I believe, I believe, I believe. I believe, I believe. I believe, I believe. I know that I know, I know that I know, 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 I know. But that ain't going to do anything. I mean, that's maybe a good beginning. At least you're going after something earnestly, right? With a lot of I believes and knows. But you press in around. You say, Lord, it's an interaction. It's a fit. It's an intimacy. Yes. It's a love. It's just a love. It's a desperate need. It's a desperate thing. I can tell you this. I know enough about it that when Moses was standing there with the bush burning, he never wanted to leave there. He wanted to stay there forever. He was saying, I can't go, because he didn't want to. I can't go talk to them. He wanted to stay right there. He was captivated by the life, the love, the glory, the beauty, the splendor. Everything that you know as good of life, about life, is found there in his presence. And it's only found in his presence. Beyond all that you could imagine. But everything you know about it is there, but beyond all that you could imagine. The love beyond all the, a love that goes beyond all that the love that you've ever loved. The joy that goes beyond all joy that you've ever joyed in. He didn't want to leave. And that's why he's like, it's like that's why he's desperate. He's back. So he says, you know, how will they know that you sent me? Well, I'll tell you what. You go and you can come back and worship me. And that was it. It was the end of conversation. For most of us, from a logical point of view, that did not satisfy the need. Huh? That's the after the fact. That's not in the fact. Are you with me? Amen. But that's all he needed, because he didn't want to go in the first place. Okay, I can have this? You can have this. He comes back, and he's in it. And he's like, and now he's not happy with just being in it. He's now got to see it more. He's desperate. He's passionate. And now you understand why he say, no, I'm not leaving. I'm not going. I'm staying here. He's telling them, you're going to lead them into a place that flows with milk and honey, your great inheritance I promised your father, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He's going, no, I'm not going. I'm not leaving. I'm not going anywhere. I'm staying right here with you. And we read it as, unless you go up with us, let us remain here. That's how we read it in the King James. But he's going, no. You're here, I'm here. I'm staying with you. I don't want to leave this. I want this. See, this encounter, this come taste and see. Probably most of the people in here, you've tasted the power of the world to come. You've tasted it. You've, because of the nature of this church, you've tasted it. You've tasted it. It becomes a whole lot better. It becomes so much better that you cannot live without it. Amen. That you've got to have it. You say, all of a sudden you recognize, wait a minute. This is a real realm, and he's calling me. Yeah. And he's going to show us right now. He says, this realm is, you get to exist in this realm because you exist in me. Your whole being is in me. My blood's, you're drinking my blood, but it's just a testimony that literally my blood's flowing through you. It's like my breath breathing. You're breathing my breath. That's not your breath. That's my breath. I breathe it into you. It's
It's my breath. That's why creation looked like, on Pentecost, there was a creation, a most fundamental part of creation that took place. He breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Ghost. It just as a father breathed in a man in his nostrils the breath of life, he became a living soul. Whew. Think about it. When we eat his flesh, we're saying, my body, my being is joined to you. I'm one with you. Bone of bone, flesh of flesh. See, there's a dynamic of transition from the human to the divine. Listen to me. From the physical to the spiritual, from the earthly to the heavenly. Now what's going to happen, we begin to touch this, and then we go back and we begin to get all engrossed in all the earthly stuff, all the normal everyday things. And as we do, it becomes more secular. We begin to listen and be involved and influenced by more secular things. Then we begin to participate with more worldly things. And we're back over here trying to get touch this realm because we love this realm. God loves us. We love God. We're touching this realm, but we're compromising. And it's keeping us from fully engaging into something that this world cannot participate with. And as long as it steals our affections and vies for our attention, it produces within us doubts, unbeliefs, limitations. It's true. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life is your biggest enemies. Biggest enemies. You cannot walk with God. So long as the toys of the flesh are impressive to you, you can't have the riches of the Spirit. Can't. So the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life comes out of wars against us. Wars against our soul. But the Lord gives us the strength of his own strength and his power and might to be able to deal with it. But there's got to be a motive. There has to be a motive. If the motive is there, it doesn't matter that you have all heaven's resources, you'll never pick it up and use it. The motive is relationship. The motive is the encounter. The motive is the fellowship. That motive, then we come with the motive, the fellowship, the relationship, and there the Spirit of wisdom revelation begins to unfold before us a whole new dimension of life. Because we're stuck in the animal life. Eat, reproduce, sleep. The animal life. It's the animal kingdom. It's not the life that God meant for men. It's not about our existence. Our existence is not about food. That's what Jesus is saying. No. That's not about your existence. Your existence isn't about not about what you can gather and collect and have here. No. Look, the birds, I take care of the birds, and I take care of the animals. Come on, you're more than them. You're more than all of that. Get over here for what you're supposed to be. Get over here for what you're supposed to be. Do you want to know who you are and what you're supposed to be? We're going to take a hold of that. We're going to celebrate tonight. This is the Passover, the whole initiation, the whole moment of beginning, the new thing. The new year, the new age, the new dispensation, the new man, the new creation. We got to be willing to say, I'm not interested in hanging out with the old anymore. I want to get on with the new. Yeah. Father's in the new and he wants to get on with the new and he's made a new heaven, a new earth, and you want to live in the old one? You're in another world, you're another dimension, you're another place. He's not there. He loves you. You love him. He's reaching you. You're reaching him. But you got to decide, no, I'm going to jump on the ship. I'm going to jump on the ship. I'm going to stay in the new. I want the new. I want the new. I want to break the barrier. Addictions are broken through fasting and praying.
Amen.
No coffee. No coffee while you're fasting and praying. None. You can't have coffee. You can't have this stuff. Some of you, no chocolate. They say, did you fast? Yeah, I did. What did you do? I had no chocolate, 21 days. Whatever. I mean, and it's, you know, I'm just being funny. But look, it breaks addictions. It breaks patterns, cycles, wrong thought patterns. It breaks it. I break it. I promise you to break it. And somebody was saying to me one day, they said, I'd just give anything if I could just walk with God right and get over this certain thing, they were saying. I said, no problem. They said, really? I said, no problem. I got a solution right now. I promise you, if you will listen to me, and if you'll do exactly what I set them up, if you listen to me, if you'll do exactly what I say to do, I promise you, it will be completely and forever broken. Okay, whatever. You tell me. 21-day fast. Suddenly, my information was no longer valuable. They wanted some little wand and, you know, passing of the hand or whatever. Some few words. No, no, no. There's a consecration. There's a commitment. You set yourself into this thing. You put yourself into this pattern of life. God has already broken it by the blood of Jesus Christ. Now you need to lay hold on the provision that he's given you and start thinking right. And fasting will help you to start thinking right, because fasting will help you to start praying right. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 You know, for when I first started fasting, man, it was like, oh God, I'm hungry. I'm so hungry, it's hard for me to think about anything else. Boy, am I ever hungry. I talked to the Lord about being hungry. Lord, how many hours have I gone? Lord, would you hold it against me if I broke this fast? Huh? But I'm going to tell you right now, you stay with it, there's a breakthrough. I don't think I made it through. No, I did. I didn't make it through my first day fasting. Barely. 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 But it's just like anything else. You give yourself to it. Come on. There's a place. Come on. Shopomanika. Shopomanika pana miki shipokone tata. Liporomon jiliki pana kishapa. Spiritual food. Spiritual drink. Spiritual insight, spiritual dominion, spiritual authority, in the name of Jesus Christ. Now listen, I'm going to tell you right now, I just heard something in the spirit. You watch out for the people around you. There's an assignment God's going to give you. You watch out for the, listen to me. Well, listen to me. You watch out for the people around you. You know somebody that is around you, son, just a little. You know somebody that's around you goofing off? Everybody else, I want you to come have communion. And then we just see where we're at. We might worship a bit, but I want you guys to come have communion because I'm getting ready to do it. Just everyone, want everybody to come up here. Listen, everybody come on up. Just weave the line together. I want you, I hear something in the spirit of the Lord saying, you see somebody diddle-dallying around, messing around, you know they're not doing what's right. You get up in their face and say, listen, I know you're not doing what's right. You hear me? Yes. Listen, God's giving you an assignment. Can you hear me? Yes. I want you to hear me. God gives you an assignment. Some of you have to go and serve. The first shall be last, and the last shall be first. Some of you have to recognize that the line is back there. I mean, I praise God for you wanting to press in, break through. Amen. But there's only going to be one line here. We want you to do this. God wants you to do this. You can do it in love. You can rebuke one another in love. You can speak the truth in love. You say, look, now listen. You know, I know you're not doing what's right. And you hold people responsible around you. Parents, you hold your children responsible. And parents, if you've not been hearing from the Lord, during this time of fasting and praying, say, Lord, I want to know what's going on in my house. I don't want to just wonder. Look, if you've got even any concern, get in the face of your children. And leaders in the church, you watch for people around you. We want to help one another. And dear people, brothers and sisters, I mean, you got to look at it like that. You're protecting one another. It's your brother. It's your sister. You're not going to set a trap for them, stand around and laugh at them because they got snagged. Huh? Nor in any way hurt them or abuse them because they're holy to the Lord. Holy. Holiness said to the Lord. The Lord's going to hold you responsible for defiling his sacred things. Huh? Husbands, I said that to wives. Wives, I say that to husbands. Children, I say that to you for your towards your parents. Parents, I said that to you towards your children. I didn't do everything right with my children, but I want you to know something. I repented vehemently, intensely. I cried out to God. And for me, I believe that that's what then dissolved and made of none effect my wrongs. Can you hear what I'm saying? I didn't do everything right. Somebody said, oh, you raised children. How did you do right? I'll tell you right now what I did right. I walked with the Lord and I repented vehemently when I did wrong. And I repentance is true because you pursue what's right. Repentance is not true so that you can go do it again. Repentance is true because you pursue what's right. Doesn't necessarily mean that you're not going to get snared or tripped up by the same thing again. But then that repentance is, once again, that much more resolved, this ain't happening again. And if that's not in your spirit, there's something wrong. And you better be careful to take this cup because the Lord said you're going to die. You're going to get sick and die. You should be careful. Just know. No, I'm serious with God. Because the Lord says to us, he says, don't eat and drink unworthily. Because you eat and drink damnation. That's powerful, isn't it? You know, standing before people that couldn't get healed of diseases or having, you know, couldn't get a breakthrough or just sitting in the meeting, you know, just staring at me with a glare, and they believe they, you know, full of the Holy Ghost. It comes as a revelation when all of a sudden you see somebody in that state and you recognize they have eaten and drinking damnation to their soul. That's a pretty heavy thing, isn't it? No sense in eating and drinking damnation because you want to be a poser or a pretender or you don't want to be real with God. Just be real with God. Just be real. He loves us. His mercy, but he does not have mercy for somebody who says that they want to walk right with God, and they know that they want to. Their heart's divided. They want to continue to run around in sin and iniquity too. Can you listen to me? God's people who've been changed by the power of the blood, by the power of the Spirit, they don't want anything else to do with that life. Do you hear me? They don't want anything else to do with that life. And that's the point that I'm trying to make very clear. It's one thing to get tripped up into something. It's another thing to want to live a dual life. I believe we're going to step into 2017 seeing the great exploits with God, but it's a double-edged sword. With the greater display of his presence and of his power, the greater the judgment. Because mercy is always rejoicing over judgment, but those God, the sacred things of God are still sacred. And you want to be doused, bathed in the blood of Jesus, huh? Hallelujah. And in the ark of safety, baptized and filled with the Holy Ghost. You know, this is what God's calling us to do. We're holy people. We're a holy lump. We're a new lump. We're a holy bread. It's like we're a holy dough. That's what the lump is. It's dough. We're a holy dough. A new dough for the bread making. Fresh bread. The Lord just takes us to make fresh bread out of us every time we meet somebody that gets something fresh from heaven. Praise God. So you have an assignment. You have an assignment. Don't let people around you be doing things, be misbehaving and sneaking around. Say, no, you're not right with God. You need to get right with God. You need to confess. And you get this thing right. And help them. I mean, you know, don't be rough or harsh with them. You know what I'm saying. Speak the truth in love. But tonight, I do not, listen, no one is allowed to take this communion because your parents told you you had to. Parents, if your kids are not living right and you know they're not living right and you bring them to this table, it's on your head. Because I believe that that's where deceit is born in many people's hearts. Kids are raised in church. The parents don't do what they're supposed to do. in terms of seeing their kids established, and they're forcing the things of God on them. You hear me? I've known of people forcing their kids to speak in tongues. And all they're doing is making a deceitful religious person out of them. And don't do that. If your kids aren't right, you don't bring them to the table. From here on in, just make sure that you understand it. You're now more accountable for it. It's very important because, you know, this might be a bit of a mixed company here tonight with the New Year's and whatnot. Sacred. Sacred. I'm going to hold the parent, says the Lord, responsible tonight. I'm not going to stand here and be the judge. If you come to this table, I will break the bread and hand you the cup. Okay? You need to examine yourself. You need to make sure. There's nothing wrong, especially with your children. If they don't understand this, if they're not walking right with God, just hold them back. Fine. They can just be right around you. Families ought to be together right now. There shouldn't be any families apart anyways. You need to come up with as a family, have communion. And then you just take the bread and the juice. And so what I'm going to do, in fact, here's what I'm going to do. For the parents that have children, I'm going to give you the bread and the juice because I want to make sure some of the kids can easily think this is refreshment time. And you're going to share a cup with them. You share the cup with them so that they recognize this isn't snacks. You share the cup with them so that they recognize, wait, this we don't do this normally, you know. At the house, when we're having refreshments. We're all drinking from one cup and eating from one bread. Then, now that I've said that, I'm going to say this. We are one cup, and we are one bread. The Lord made us one cup and one bread to all be a part of one body. And that's so important that you receive and that you participate with that tonight, and so that there is no broken members here tonight. None. I break off anything in your life right now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth that would hold you back in some kind of an offense or some kind of insecurity or sense of separation. Now in Jesus' name, that thing's off you so you won't be any broken members with some foul memory. In Jesus' name. This represents the new year. It represents the new day. It represents the acceptable year. It represents that new thing that we can have continually. Amen? So that we're never part of the old thing. Never be a part of the old thing more than a second. Amen. Come, bro. Love you so much. Love you so much. Bless you. Love you. Love you so much. Hallelujah. Love you so much, Aaron. Bless you. Thank you, come. Sutambra Sikishta Lamoprata. I say small children, you're not that small. Thank you, Jesus. Harobo Setara Nikishti. I love you so much. Hallelujah. Umbrasa tequila. Hey, Mom. Mama's going to take care of it, okay, baby? Come and let all the parents do that tonight. Yeah, you're going to take care of it right from there. Okay. Hey, you're going to go. I'll break bread together.
Okay.
Love you. Love you so much, dear. Father, thank you for the wonderful works. Amborostika. Amborostika. Love you. Love you. Shikam brasat. Sikim brasit esta. Love you. Shilendor rustatani. Siestatis to be. Love you, dear. Love you, Josh. Love you, dear. Bless you. Love you, dear. Bless you. Love you. Love you, dear.
cave. Love you. No. One cup. She wants to talk to me. She wants to rest. For your family. In a cup. Hey, boys, you guys are older. You can come back. Mom, take care of the little one. You guys come back. Come. Okay. Here, Mom. I'll let you take care of the boys, except for Elijah, okay? Here you go, Dad. I'm always amazed every time I ever say this, and every time I just consider it, that the Lord highlights communion in this glorious mercy with the statement on the night that he was betrayed. It's amazing. I betrayed him way too many times. Peter betrayed him. Every time we find ourselves doing our own way and trying to execute Father's will on our own terms, it's an act of betrayal. But in the midst of that, in the midst of him being able to say, tonight, as the scripture says, he's quoting Zechariah, the shepherd will be smitten and the sheep will be scattered. He said, every one of you are going to forsake me. And yet in the midst of that, he takes the bread and he breaks it. And he says, this is my body, which is given to you, which is broken for you. And it's just an amazement to me. It was not a peaceful division, but one that was brought to pass by the lash of the whip, by the tear of the cat of nine tails. It was one that was brought about by a crown of thorns in a pierced body. It's
just amazing. Sin demanded that kind of punishment. He laid the sins of us all upon him. He took the sins of the whole world upon himself. He bore our sins in his own body on the tree. His life came to an end that our lives may begin. Just amazing. He was bruised for our transgressions. He was wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities. Through his chastisement, through his brutal scourging and beating, we have peace. It's amazing. If God loved us so much that he spared not his own son, but offered him up for the sins of us all, insomuch that Isaiah said, it pleased the Father to bruise him because he saw you and I eating communion tonight and receiving the glorious salvation that he freely gave. He's amazing, God. That deserves a shout. You know what I'm saying? Deserves that continual praise of thanksgiving. And I pray today that it will begin once again the beginning of days, as Passover is supposed to be, as receiving this new covenant, receiving this amazing grace of divine redemption that God has granted to us, should always be a moment of new beginning. Should always be a moment of thanksgiving. It's always new. It's new because it keeps becoming more revealed and more understood and more appreciated and more valued and more received. And so every year the praise ought to be more exotic. The worship more dramatic. In the midst of everybody being all upset with Jesus and asking for a sign after he's worked so many amazing miracles on that day recorded in John chapter 6, that they wanted to come and take him by force and make him king, and he knew they were going to try to force it on him, so he just separated himself and disappeared from their midst. And then the very next day, they're being all uppity with him and demand that he gives a sign. He said, this is the sign. Moses did not give you the true bread from heaven. I am the true bread. If any man eats this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I give to you is my life, my body. I give my body, my life for you so that you can live by me. I live on Jesus. Somebody said, we can't live unless we eat. We all got to eat. Jesus said, the meat that I'm going to give you is meat indeed. It's my body. I live by him. We live on him. Instead of living on food, we live in on him. We're living by him and on him and through him. His blood was not only shed for our sins, but for the sins of the whole world. But you know what? The whole world has not participated with what he's done. And so it's not effective in their lives. But tonight we're participating. So don't doubt for a second of its effectiveness in your life. Because if you begin to see and understand what God has done, I promise you the joy and the rejoicing and the blast of praise will become louder and louder, and the thanksgiving will become will become deeper and deeper, and the value and the appreciation will result in perfect obedience. Lord, we thank you for this bread. Jesus said, if you eat this bread and drink this blood, you have eternal life. If, in other words, he's saying, if you will receive the miracle that I have worked for you in the giving of my body, in the beginning of my blood, in the giving of my life, you shall be a new creation. That's what he's saying. It's not a ritual, a cult. He's saying, if you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you shall have eternal life. If you do not eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have no life. You do not have eternal life. He's just saying, if you receive and participate with the miracle that I provided for you in this act of redemption, you shall be a new creation, possessor of the very divine life of God. And I want everybody to grab a hold of it tonight. God says he wants everybody to grab a hold of it tonight, because if you'll believe it, you'll start living by his life instead of your life. You'll take a firm grip on eternal life. You'll fight the good fight of faith. You won't look to human power or result to human answers, but you'll have divine power and rely upon divine abilities, because you're in him and he's in you, and you're seated in a glorious realm of divine power and authority over all sin and sickness and disease, so that nothing can by any means hurt you or harm you, because you've received this life or you've been born again. We know that everyone is born of God, sinneth not, he keeps himself, and the wicked one can't touch him. You've received this eternal life. You're living by him. It's those moments that we quit living by him that we become vulnerable to the stuff called sin, to the deceptions of the enemy. So evermore, evermore, evermore give me this water to drink. Evermore, evermore, give me this bread to eat. Evermore. Lord Jesus, you are our Passover.
You are
the beginning
of our life.
You are the beginning of this year.
You rule
and dominate
over everything
that will be done.
Your kingdom is forever.
And the increase of your kingdom,
there shall be no end.
And the increase of your government,
there shall be no end.
And Lord, tonight we recognize
that you sit on the seat of government,
that you've been exalted in a place far above
all principalities and powers.
You are King of Kings.
You are Lord of Lords.
And you've given to us your flesh.
And you've given to us your body.
And we thank you so much.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Bilamongashira. I'm alone to buy.
Hallelujah.
Lord, your flesh is meat indeed. Hallelujah. And your blood is drink indeed. And after the supper was ended, he took the cup and he said, this is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out to you and for you, so that your sins may be blotted out, removed, erased, forgotten, never to be remembered again, never to be held to your account. I mean, it would be one thing if the Lord just instituted it and then took a knife, like the Native American, cut his wrist and let some blood drip out.
But the way that that blood had to be delivered, no one could have thought. He comes as a lamb that has been slaughtered, but worse than slaughtered. Tortured before he slaughtered. There was no real description of what Jesus went through. There were types and shadows, but all of those lambs and all the sacrifices were handled with gentle care. And the greatest care, concern, when they were slaughtered, when their throats were slit and the blood went squirting everywhere and caught in the basin by the priest. Jesus, with his own blood, so that you and I have not been redeemed by corruptible things, not by a purchase of money, not by a transaction of trade, but by Christ Jesus, by God Almighty, pouring out his life unto death, showing to us the absolute consecration to the obedience to the will of God. The absolute consecration to obedience, that the worst kind of torture could not make him disobey. That the most hideous torture that men could execute upon man could not cause him for one moment to disobey. And that perfect obedience and that perfect sacrifice in the cost of pouring out for us such redemption, we must be able to see it so that we don't take it for granted and take it so lightly. But understand that we were not redeemed with corruptible things of silver and gold, but at a great expense and a great cost, both to God and to Christ Jesus, the God-man. I don't understand it. Why he comes as a lamb slain and worse, tortured. I don't understand it. Other than the Lord laid upon him the sins of us all, that he took in his body our sins and paid the full price, hideous price that sin deserves. And I still don't understand it after that. But I thank you so much, Jesus. And I know it's my double cure. I know it's double cure enough that sin has no power over me. I know it's double cure enough that every sin that I've ever committed is completely forgotten, erased, and removed. And I will never face it in eternity. I will never face it in the future. I will never face it. Every sin that anybody's ever committed has for it, listen to me, the just consequence of judgment of the slightest little sin, the slightest lie, anything, an eternity of death. How many deaths should you die? How many eternal deaths should you die? Should I die? Should we fall worthy of? And yet he's erased it with the act of his sacrifice. Not just any sacrifice. Hideous torture beyond anything that we could imagine. Amazing. You're amazing. The power of the blood of Jesus Christ not only removes sin, it removes its power and its authority, so that if you sin, you willfully stand up and commit an act of treason. You and I, we willfully stand up and commit an act of treason far greater than Adam committed. And that's why Paul said that if under the administration and leadership of Moses, they should be thought worthy of death to transgress upon the holy things, of how much worse punishment should you and I be thought worthy of if we should take and, as it were, pour out the blood of Jesus, despise it, and trample it. We'll just walk over it and smear it in the ground and outrage the Holy Ghost.
This is very sacred to Father. What the Lord did to redeem us is very sacred to Father. If I grabbed you right now and started beating you in the face and pulverizing your face to where blood was flying out, within 2 hours your face would be swollen 3 times bigger than it is. Just, it puffs up. When you get beat in the face like that, your face will puff way up. It wouldn't even compare. It wouldn't even begin to compare to what he went through to provide for us his blood, to provide this for us. I don't understand it. But I want to appreciate it, I want to value it, and I want to know it, and I want to grab a hold of the power of it, because it's such power. It came by great torture, by great affliction, by great consecration. You talk about a 21-day fast, talk about a 40-day fast, easy. Give me an 80-day fast, whatever. But to be beaten and flogged with a cat of nine tails, 39 lashes. That's 39 times 9, really. Plus all of the glass, all of the bone, all of the shards that rip and tear your flesh and your muscle. Because it's every one is like a razor blade. It's like a razor blade. Really, the way to describe it is you've got a long length of cord. There's 9 of them. And all the way through it is razor blades. But they're unique razor blades because they're claws and they're hooks. They're fish hooks. They're shark hooks. The same thing as. And smack, it comes upon you, and it's ripped. And it's not a hard pull, because they're so sharp, they slice right through your body. And that's done 39 times. And 9 of them go across your back, or go across your stomach. And that's the way he delivered this to me. I don't understand it. I want to understand it. It happened. It's real. The human frame, my concepts, my intellect can never touch it. But God would show it to me and show it to you by the spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of him. We were not redeemed with corruptible things such as silver and gold, but by the precious blood of a lamb. The precious blood of Jesus Christ as a lamb without spot or blemish. Every act was an act of intense, as it were, trial, affliction, and suffering. From the very first part of his ministry. I believe he turned the water into wine and made 180 gallons of fresh wine at the feast, far more than they needed, so that he could say, this is the new covenant, this is the new age, and I supply plenty of grace. I supply plenty of provision for all that you have need of. If you'll grab a hold of the power that is in the blood of Jesus, you and I step over into an interaction with the Father, because we can come boldly by the blood of Jesus, and that's the only way we come. And now and forever and throughout all the ages to come. Not on the merit of our good or our bad, upon our successes or our failing, but simply because of the precious blood of Jesus forever and forever and forever. This is how we come. We come with all boldness. By the blood of Jesus Christ, we come into this realm, we come into this interaction, that we can step into a place, Cade, with the Lord, that we begin to interact with him in such a way, in the one-on-one, that when we stand before men, heaven's glory overwhelms them. Because we've been talking with Papa. Let me hold him for just a minute. He's crying out for me. Oh, thank you, Jesus. The other night, what was it, Sunday night? Little Ezekiel sat there and his eyes was fixed on me as I'm preaching and ministering. Captivated by the presence of the Lord, just captivated. I said, oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Captivated. Oh, we're just having a good time in the church. We came to the Lord's New Year's party tonight. This is the feast that he said. We had his celebration. We enjoyed his celebration, aren't we? Woo-hoo! Praise God. Praise God for the preacher. Praise God for the preacher.
Jesus. We cannot even begin to express nor understand your sacrifice. But we know that only love could have taken you there. And only love could have kept you there. If you can understand love, you can understand the overcoming power. If you can understand love, you can understand a consecration and a commitment and a dedication that moves you way beyond obligation and discipline. Where He's won your heart. And that's surrender. Lord Jesus, tonight I take a hold of the power of this blood that you poured out for me. This new covenant, this new beginning, this new testament, this acceptable year of the Lord, this new year of the Lord. And Lord, I lay hold on the insight and the revelation that sin has no power over me. And that it has been condemned to the flesh is not supposed to exist in me. And that if you can suffer and be tried and even tortured and remain in perfect obedience, surely I can receive this power and this authority and this provision that you've given to remain in perfect obedience. And I want to learn. And I want to know it. And I want to grab a hold of it. To know and believe the love that God has for us. God is love. And there's no greater expression of it, people. So when you start doubting God's love, grab yourself some communion. When you start wondering, are you right with God? Are you worthy? Grab a hold of some communion. When the enemy starts condemning you, browbeating you, whatever, grab a hold of some communion. And look at what God did to purge our conscience from dead works. And look at what He did to give us a conscience void of offense. To where you so step into what this provision of redemption did for you and me, that there is no question nor doubt in your thinking, in your heart, anywhere in your life about how holy and acceptable you are. Isn't that beautiful? And let us go and change the world.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Let us go in the fullness of the Spirit, in the fullness of the power of the blood of Jesus, in the full expressions of His life and of His glory, having laid hold on this beauty and this splendor made available to us by the new creation and by the baptism in the Holy Ghost, so that people are literally burned with the fire of God, as it were, and as we preach, overwhelmed by the beauty of His love and of His splendor, like staring at a bush on fire that does not burn, like looking at a mount that is set on fire with the glory of God, and out of the midst of the fire that enfolds upon itself, the audible voice of God speaks. Let's let God's glory be fully manifested in us. And anytime any doubt or shame or rejection or inferiority or guilt or whatever starts to mess with you, grab a hold of some communion. Grab a hold of some fellowship, because this is all our fellowship. This is all our communion. This is all our right to interaction. Thank you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you. I am washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb, and my garments are spotless, they are whiter than snow. I am washed in the blood of the Lamb. Thank you, Father, for the blood of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, for your sacrifice. Thank you, Father, for your only begotten Son. I am washed in the blood. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, Happy New Year. Hallelujah. Father, thank you for this new year. Thank you, Lord. Woo-hoo! Woo-hoo! Thank you, Lord. Woo-hoo! Thank you, Holy Spirit. Oh, God, have your way in our lives. Find us perfectly obedient, totally yielded, completely surrendered, worshiping you. Praising you, thanking you, celebrating you, rejoicing over you. Hallelujah. Well, I want you to make a point of going and hugging every single person in the place. Find everyone, and you know, if you've got to stand in line, whatever, find every single one and hug every person in the place. That is the commission for you tonight. Just go do it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, I kind of keep a record of how many people are actually hugging everyone, because only two or three hug me. Every time, only two or three hug me.
Hallelujah.
That's how I know that only two or three are really obeying everything, you know.
Hallelujah.